Welcome to Zaluko Brothers Podcast. I have with me Indian travelers Avi and Ruchi, who has traveled 17 countries, sold everything they had in 2016, quit their jobs and travel worldwide and just stay at a place without a plan for months together as they wish. I mean, this is the kind of podcast I'll release on a Monday morning just to make everybody's Monday blues worse, because everybody is just so jealous of people like you, especially in COVID time, especially working from home, especially on a Monday morning, right? So this will be a nice podcast for Monday. And this is the kind of podcast, this is the kind of topic that I can talk for about like 4 hours and 5 hours, because I mean, the kind of experiences that you will have, right? You can start your own podcast on your own. Absolutely. Because yeah. one episode per country, or because you stay 3 months in every country, maybe 4 or 5 episodes per country, because there must be a ton of experiences, right? But I don't know how long this podcast will last, how long you have in your hands. This can very easily break my record of the previous podcast episode, which was like 2.5 hours, because I can just go on and on about travel. I have traveled 8 countries myself, and I am one of those people, when I look back at this podcast and edit this, I'll just feel so bad and angry, right? Because I had tickets for World T20 Australia, okay, which was supposed to happen in 2020. I had the tickets for India vs England match in Melbourne, and my aunt lives in New Zealand, so I thought, okay, Australia, New Zealand, you know what, 2020 trip sorted. So I'm like one country per year kind of guy, been to 8 so far. So I'm one of those pissed off people who'll be pissed off on a Monday morning. But welcome to the podcast, Avinasha and Ruchika. Thank you very much for joining and taking some time out from your busy schedule, if you're busy, if I'm assuming it right.
Thank you so much for having us. Najib. Yes, it's a nice morning here in Mexico City. It's about like 10:30 a.m. So we just had coffee and we're ready to make you jealous.
Oh, yes, please. I can't wait to get jealous, because straight away I want to ask, what are you doing in a country that Trump hates so much, right? What is so beautiful about it?
The fact that Americans and Trump hate it so much will make it a great place, because when we went to the US, we were quite disappointed. We went to some of the cities that we've heard a lot about, right? Like New York, Los Angeles, Miami, San Francisco. So we hit up all these cities that kind of captured our imaginations as teenagers, considering all movies, TV shows, books and everything are based out of these cities.
Yep.
So it wasn't we are happy that we got to travel in Asia and got to travel in South America as well, because I wouldn't consider US to be on the top of my travel bucket list anytime soon. It was not amazing, I would say.
Yeah, one of the things about like our travel to the US is that like we didn't go to the US first. Like if we did 2 years in Asia and we have seen other cities, we have seen like how life is outside of India, but not in the US.
Yeah.
So when we went to the US, it was kind of disappointing for us, because our experiences in the US were not up to the expectation of, like Ruchi said, how the media portrays, and there are way better cities in the world to be in.
Yeah, exactly.
Than in like any of the US cities.
Explain me. Sorry.
Including Mexico City.
Yeah.
Right. Explain me more about that. What is it about US cities that disappointed you? Like, was it too much of fake concretized jungles? There was no life to the streets of the US city, because everyone is, it's more individualistic.
Yeah, exactly. That's probably it, because for us, one of the main things about travel is the people. It's like, one of the most important aspects of a country or the city is how the people are, right? And we don't mind urban jungles or concrete, whatever, because we love big cities. We love the chaos of cities. We love the culture and the youth energy that every city has. Every city is different. Capital cities are very vibrant and engaging. So that wasn't it. I felt like, for example, in a place like New York or LA, there are a lot of different cultures, but it's not like they want anything to do with you. They are not welcoming. It's like, it's my city. I don't care about any tourists. I don't care if you have a good time or anything. And although if you have to say about any racist experience, we would say maybe one or two, which are not so significant. But people were very closed off. Like in New York, you say every culture in the world is represented in New York, right?
Yeah.
That's what they say. There's African communities, Senegalese communities, Chinese, Bhutanese, so many communities are represented, but they want nothing to do with you. When you come into their neighborhoods, they're like, just pay us money and yeah.
Or with each other. There are communities there, but they're all like in silos. They're all separated. Nobody like intermingles. So it basically is, it's just like, yes, you can go to different communities, but it feels like entering different countries.
Yeah,
but
like if you go to the Korean community or the Chinese community, it is a clear vibe that you are not welcome here. Mm. Spend your money and leave.
Wow. I mean, here's the thing, right? First of all, when I look at North America, I've never been to North America. But for me, I don't have respect for cities which don't have proper public transport. Because for me, when I go to a city, right, I don't roam around a new city in a private taxi or stuff like that. I catch the bus. I catch the train. Right. I walk on the street. Right. You not only want to see the city, you want to listen to the city, you want to smell it. You know, you want to taste it.
How you discover food. Things. Like you just see some street cart and you're like, okay, let's see what this is about.
Yeah.
Or you walk around near a school or college and you see what kids are up to, what they're
And North America is a place where you can't survive without a car. It's not a pedestrian. No. I don't look like, it doesn't look like, you know, from the outside, obviously. It doesn't look like a pedestrian friendly place to me, right? It's very car friendly in a sense. Unlike Europe.
You have
Europe,
to have a car, yes.
Yeah. Europe is very pedestrian friendly and very public transport friendly in a sense. So yeah, that is number one complaint for me when it comes to North American countries. We'll get to that. But for me, I want to get started with the fact that you left everything in 2016, right? Just define everything for me in a second.
So we had a rented apartment in Bangalore.
Where?
It's not like our own house or HSR layout.
All right.
I mean that everything is actually not a lot.
Okay.
Yeah. So we made sure. We had this rented apartment,
right?
And we were like, we started planning this since we met, like for 2 years before we started traveling. So we were like, if we are going to travel like this, we don't have to.
Hang on a second. You were working somewhere, obviously.
Yes.
Right.
So he was already a digital nomad. He had already been in, traveling and living in Chile and Vietnam and Nepal and stuff. And then when he met me, I was a lawyer and I was working full time in India, and he had to wait for me to catch up. So we tried a short trip where we decided, let's go to Thailand, Cambodia and stuff. And we ran out of like our planned budget in 2 weeks because it was just completely unplanned.
The budget was basically like we wanted to last it for like 3 months to do it in 3 months, but we just it got over in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Right.
So we were like, okay, we better plan this properly.
Yeah. So when we came back, we were like, let's give ourselves 2 years to plan it out and see how fast or slow we would like to travel. And then we made sure that our house had no furniture. We didn't spend money on furniture or like...
what do you call that? Minimalistic living.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so, we had one table to work on.
We had one table and two chairs. So one time his parents arrived and then we were like, just wait here in the hall. So his parents stood in the hall while we went down and bought some plastic chairs from some nearby shop. So that kind of minimalistic. Just some kitchen stuff, a bed and a table and two chairs.
I have a great feeling that you and me will become very good friends, because I'm not a big fan of owning stuff anyways, right? It's just I just don't understand. I literally don't understand. I mean, I go to a bachelor's place and it's just minimal and he's living fine, and suddenly he gets married, he has like 100 plastic bowls. Like why like who are you feeding the street? Or like, that's a different conversation. Materialism is a different conversation. So, wait a minute. What do you mean by digital nomad, Avinash? What do you mean by digital nomad? She's a digital nomad.
So, a digital nomad is a term which is used for people who work in tech, usually. I'm a programmer.
Anything digital.
Yeah, anything digital. I'm a programmer.
Right.
Usually people work in digital marketing or design. Anything like you work in digital where you make money, but you're nomads. Like you're not you don't be in a single place.
Right.
So this is the like all encompassing word for people like us. There's like a lot of people like us in the world.
So you're basically doing something that people are doing now in Corona, right? They are like one day they are in the grandmother's place, one day they are in like, but you are like going around the world.
I mean, if they, now that a lot of people have discovered this lifestyle because of Corona, I think a lot more people will start traveling actually, because they'll realize, why should I be in Bangalore?
Yeah, because there are a lot of startup remote companies, not so many in India, but a lot abroad. It was considered a pretty normal thing. Like a lot of companies, they can't afford to set up in the US, so they come to Asia, Asian countries.
Right.
And save a lot of money in like rent and that kind of stuff, so they can launch their company or even hire from these countries.
Right.
So
I was working for a startup in 2011, and there's a government run program called Startup Chile in South America, where you are supposed to go to Chile and work from Chile for 6 months. So that the locals can get interested in entrepreneurship. It did work that way. And our startup went to Chile. We went there, we were three of us. And that's my travel journey started. And we decided to be a remote company way before like anyone even had thought about it, like OG remote companies in tech. And that way we started like building the startup while traveling. So that's how I was already experienced in like digital nomadism, because we were building in the startup on the go. So I knew this lifestyle was possible and I really liked it. So when I met her, I met her on the day I landed from Nepal back to Bangalore, and she was traveling to Malaysia. So all we could just talk about was travel, and that was her first trip outside of India. So that's how we started conversation. And then when we started dating, we decided, okay, this lifestyle is possible and we should work towards it.
Ruchi, single girl traveling, how much convincing does it take?
Well, I wouldn't say so much convincing as much as lying. So if there are parents watching this and they're like, okay, these guys are going to be a bad influence. I'm sorry, but...
No. Please spread your bad influence as much as you can. And so, much needed in this country.
There's a little bit of convincing and then there's a little bit of lying. And I would say that as a rule, your parents don't have to know everything, one. And the second rule is your parents don't have to be happy with your decisions all the time. Mm.
Right? And third rule is smoke weed without telling. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. That's hard. You can tell them also.
Yeah. That is when you become super successful after 10 years. And then like, mom, 10 years ago, I used to smoke weed. You know that?
And it's because of that I'm successful.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's very sad that you have to lie, right? Because it's like, the reason I ask you this question is because I think of myself, right? I've traveled not as much as you have did, but I've traveled reasonably okay. And I don't think I would have traveled as much if I was a girl, right? Because I know my social conditions very well. And I know how much convincing it takes for me as a guy and how much convincing it takes for me as a girl. So that is the reason why I bought this up. So your first trip must be like so just freeing, right? That must be the most free you must have felt in your entire life.
Yeah.
And vulnerable as well, because you're alone, lost in a country that
in a
language that you don't know, right?
Yeah. So my parents are fairly chill in the sense that they are okay with like when I told them I don't want to be
Avinash, because here's the thing. We are guys. Because it's easy for us.
Issues.
There's nothing to talk about, all right?
For guys.
Yeah.
Go ahead, no issues.
So it's like one is a cultural thing for parents to be like, oh, my daughter is traveling alone and stuff. It's more fear, right? But if there is no, if you feel like you can get over that and parents and the rest of the society have a lot to, you know, to make sure that that conditioning slowly goes away and women are like, they just get up and they decide, okay, fine, I'm going to go out with a bunch of girlfriends. That should be as normal as it is for guys, I feel.
Right.
So for me, it wasn't. even though my parents are chill about other things, like I told them I want to quit my job and I don't want to be a lawyer anymore, that was easy for them. Or if I told them, no, I don't want to get married anymore, I don't want an arranged marriage, I want to date a few people before I decide, that was also okay for them. So, but travel was something they're like, ah, okay, you know, it wasn't like they didn't take me seriously when I said I want to travel. So when I booked my first trip to Malaysia, they did like warm up to the idea that, okay, I can travel and stuff like that. And like, of course, I kept in touch with them every day. And
I think the fact is it doesn't even come to their imagination, right? It's like,
exactly. Why are you going to Malaysia? Need to go?
Yeah. Alone is the biggest word. Like, it's not a company trip. Like,
exactly. So my parents are like, why don't you go to the US, go stay with some auntie, some cousin? Why do you want to go to Malaysia? Malaysia mein kya hai? You know, like, that's what strikes them, that even if you have to travel for fun, why don't you go to a relative somewhere? But that's the relatives are the opposite of fun, right?
Oh my God, I don't want to offend my relatives right
so
now.
So when I started dating Avi and I told them, okay, this is the kind of thing we're planning, that we're going to have in a few years, we are going to just give up everything and travel like nomads for a while. And they never took it seriously until we were like, okay, our lease is done. We are coming to Delhi for some visa work and to see you. And then we're leaving. And then they were like, oh, okay. And then for the past, I think, 4 years, they've always expect us to settle down for a bit. My mom is like, why don't you take the car and just settle down in India? Kahin pe bhi raho, but just, you know, think about settling down. But it's been 4 years and we still feel like we're getting started.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, it's as if that stuff is reserved for white people, right? It's only white people who just go around, roam around. Yeah. Indians, and Indians don't do that. Probably it comes from the economic situation a little bit, but most of it is stigma, especially for a woman. Most of it is just 90% is stigma, right?
And, when you get married, it's like, sometimes if there are things that I just want to say, okay, Avinash said it and I'm just the wife. Don't look at me.
Yeah, one more. This is another shit, right? Yeah, why don't you travel with the husband? Like, why the fuck? I mean,
exactly.
That's it. I get it, right?
Really, if you find someone who is super open minded, if you get a guy who is like, I feel like you get a free pass on things you wanted to do, but you were too hesitant to do when you were single. So when I met him, it was like, I wanted to go to Philippines alone and he had some wedding to attend or something. So he was like, I can't come. So he was like, go alone. And
I'll do that. Totally. Yeah. If she's up for it, I'll do that.
And we were already married. So when I told my parents, I have to go to Philippines, Avinash can't come.
No, without, like, husband. Without husband. Yeah. What?
No, they were chill because husband is permitted, right? And you can't really say much after your
husband. But Mr. Husband, did you get any weird views? Like, what the fuck, he's leaving his
wife?
No, the biggest weird view was in the visa, like Philippines visa process, where I had to write a no objection certificate as an official document for her to go to Philippines because I am the husband.
This is some Saudi Arabia shit, huh?
Yeah, you have to either get the no objection from your father or from your husband.
So we were sitting in front of the visa officer or the person who was collecting the documents, and there was a no objection certificate. So I just turned to her and, like, in fun, I said, okay, should I write this? Should I permit?
But will they expect it from the husband though? That's, I'm curious.
No,
like,
no, nothing. So either if she was not married, the no objection should come from the parents.
Oh my.
And if married, I should give the no objection.
Oh my. So, this is Kingdom of Philippines Arabia.
Yeah. But I mean, I feel
this
like
is
it's
nothing to
it's
do
a
with Philippines it, though.
I don't feel so I feel insulted about it because I am a city girl and I earn my own money and I feel like, okay, I should be allowed to do whatever the hell I want to without anyone's permission.
This is exactly
but
what they do in Saudi Arabia.
There's a lot of trafficking and there's a lot of, like, those kind of things. So I can understand why from a country like India, they would require
but
this.
But that's the thing. Like, this has nothing to do with Philippines as a country. Mm-hmm. It's the source. Like, if Mexicans go to the Philippines embassy, mm-hmm. none of the no objection certificate, nothing is required in Mexico.
Right.
But if you are applying in India, it's required. So it's a Indian embassy, Philippines embassy in India thing, basically. So
talk about that. No, can you talk about the headaches of traveling on an Indian passport, please?
That's like the story of our lives.
Oh my god, I mean if you're staying in a country for 3 months, you'll be like 1 month you'll be spending like, let's file the application.
Yeah, pretty much.
I had anxiety, sleepless nights when I went to the UK, because UK I wanted to go because there was this adventure called wing walking where you are tied to the wing. I'm an adventure guy, so they tie you to the wing of an airplane and they fly. That is only available in UK.
That sounds...
I don't want to do that.
No.
it's sick. It is fun. It's like... I'll show you something. I'll show you exactly what I mean. But yeah, I wanted to go and I had sleepless like anxiety attacks. Like, okay, how... Because I'm a single guy. And when you go to white countries, right? When you go to white countries, single Indian guys get rejected. You know, you must be knowing this, Avinasha, right?
I got rejected twice to Europe. That's why we have not been to Europe yet.
Oh, that is sad. I mean, you know what you should do? You know what exactly you should do? You should take the excuse of one event. Okay.
Yeah. Now, so, back then when I applied for it, like I was working with this startup, as I said, and this startup didn't pay me in India. So the startup didn't have a presence in India because it was a US company.
Right.
So I couldn't prove that I'm employed in India. So that was the biggest reason why I didn't get the visa. But since then, so when we started planning, we decided, okay, we need to set things up in India for the visas to be easy.
Right.
So the first thing to do is to get the US visa because it's like the second passport.
Oh yeah.
And the second thing we did was we started an LLP with us being the, what is it?
Directors.
What is an LLP?
It's a limited liability partnership.
Right.
So okay. It's like having an office, registered office in India with the address and everything.
Classic questions of a salaried guy. Sorry, go on.
So if we want to get a letter from our HR or something, so we write it for ourselves. Yeah.
Right.
And like we'll say, okay, we work for this company.
Yeah.
So the work situation is sorted to prove that, okay, we work in India.
Yeah, that's basically all they're looking for, that some type of reason that, okay, you will come back to India.
Right. So I was telling, so I wanted to do this. So basically, I'm tied like that. So,
that looks like fun. Instead of sitting, you're tied to the plane.
Yeah.
But you're outside at
4,000. The propeller is right there.
4,000 feet.
That's 40,000. How much?
No, this is not high. This is like basically 1,000 feet, barely.
Like a bird.
Yeah, like a bird height. Exactly.
Yeah. I could do this.
Yeah, this is only available in UK. I wanted to do this, but I can't mention this in the visa reason. Okay. So I'm like, okay, now what? So I'm like, okay, I chose the 2019 Cricket World Cup, India versus England in Birmingham. And then I went backpacking to UK, north to south, totally from Loch Ness to like freaking Southampton, right? So I had anxiety attacks because there was this one guy who had already visited UK based on a single, because he was single. And I was like, I was constantly bugging him once in 2 days, like, bro, I have this salary slip missing. What do I do? He's like, bro, chill. They don't look at it like that. I'm like, bro, I don't want rejection. I freaking don't want rejection at any cost.
I mean, you will not have any problems if you have work here and work in India. As a single guy, you can prove work. And if you can show like the leave letter.
Yes.
So that's it. That is like, okay.
Yeah.
And like that leave has to be like something reasonable. Mm-mm-mm. Like if you go apply for a month, they'll be like, why? So if it is like for a week, then they're like, okay, all right.
Yeah, you can. Exactly. That's exactly what I did. But still, I'm a first timer, right? So I was like, I had sleepless nights. The day I got it, I was like, oh, God, I'm not too religious, but I just literally went like this with my passport. Anyways, But you had US visa as a couple. It must be easier for you when you got the US visa. That was my idea for the UK visa as well. Like once I get one white country visa, no, it'll be nice.
Yeah. So we made sure we'll get the US visa before we start traveling. Mm. So he was working for this company. He was actually consulting for the startup in Bangalore part-time. So he was like, it was his friend's startup. So they were like, I will give you the salary slips or whatever paperwork you need.
Wow.
So
So it's like that's the 4 months I worked with him as a consultant is the only time I've ever been on payroll. I'm like, okay, in those 4 months I need to apply for anything and everything which requires employment in India. So credit, I applied for credit cards, I applied for the US visa, I've applied for like anything which is like, okay, are you employed question? I applied in those 4 months and got
it. But we weren't married then, so I couldn't get I couldn't apply with him. But then 1 year later I applied alone. And we were married then, and I applied saying I'm going to visit my aunt in the US and come back, and they just gave me the visa. Like, okay, most
well. Yeah, as if you will, if you're single, as if you go there and you steal their guys. Yeah. Well. Like, what the fuck?
Exactly.
More like you will overstay.
Yeah.
Because I know a lot of people who just go to San Francisco and have overstayed for years.
Yeah, but having the US.
Like 3 years, 4 years, they just go there and overstay.
Yeah, exactly. Lots of people do that.
So, and what do they do? Like work, like what? Drive Uber, is it? Like what do they do?
Yeah, or do something small, like work in a hotel.
I mean, they cannot do anything official.
Yeah, they
obviously.
Yeah.
But they'll do, I mean, in the valley, you will say, okay, I'll consult paying cash. So you can do that. So, and you can make enough
money. Stop giving ideas, okay? Just don't stop giving illegal ideas.
But I mean, it's not a good thing. Like
No. Totally, guys. Absolutely not endorsing that.
What's the point of being stuck in a place where you can't even go back home and come back with a piece of money?
And the thing is, like, once you get caught, your life is screwed.
Yeah, because you'll have that big deportation stamp on your passport.
Yeah, you're living like Pablo Escobar in Colombia. It's just like, oh, I don't know, like, when I'll get caught, bro. I mean, But you went absolutely viral with your Mexican South Indian video. You got like what 6.5 lakh views. And the part that I was rolling so hard and laughing is when the guy took the dosa and he made it a taco. I was like, I lost it right there. I just, because dosa for me is like emotional, right? I'm not a big foodie and it's very easy to impress me with food. You can just cook some basic shit and impress with me. But for me, dosa is an exception because my mom and grandmom make the best dosas, right? It's so hard to impress me with a good dosa. It's a lot of memories for me. Dosa is a lot of memories. And when I saw that, I never even imagined that looked like taco. And I never imagined the guy would eat it like a taco. I mean, just the imagination, just looking at it, and he felt like it was a taco, was just so hilarious. And he made the puri a taco. That was very hilarious. What a friend.
Like taco we eat, we do like, we roll the puris up and eat. Like
bread jam, roti jam, roti aloo, that tiffin stuff. Yeah, but I mean,
the dosa taco was like, it was amazing.
Oh,
It's so nice to see culturally how they interpret our food because we feel like North Indian food, naan and butter chicken and stuff is fairly popular. Everyone abroad would have had some taste of Indian food. But things like dosa and idli and stuff like that, this is something they wouldn't have seen, a lot of people.
Right.
Like when we told them South Indian food, they were like completely blown away. They're like, we've eaten Indian food, we've been to the US, eaten Indian food, but we've not seen these things. So it was really amazing. And they loved sambar so much.
We
searched in our fridge for like Tupperwares and we gave them sambar and they took it home and they were like, next day I'm eating sambar with rice. And so it's amazing to see that they loved it. Yeah, exactly. To keep sambar in your fridge and heat it the next day and eat.
Yes.
Can't get more South Indian.
That is love. That is pure love. Yeah. I mean, classic Mexican bachelors being South Indian bachelors, basically.
I mean, but they're not, like, two of them were already married in that.
No, they had girlfriends.
One is married now.
Okay.
Yeah. So
in Indian language, when you're not married, you're a bachelor. You may have girlfriend or not. But I'm just kidding.
But it was very, like, a lot of fun for us to see their reaction.
Yeah.
And
we knew it would be a great thing to show Indians the reactions of Mexican.
Yeah, because our entire pop culture is hijacked by North Indians in a sense, right? Food, movies, Bollywood, songs, everything that foreigners get to see is North Indian pop culture.
Exactly.
Very rarely, and even if the only South Indian thing that they would know is some stereotypical Tamil song or Rajini
Khan nonsense.
And again, that is again propagated by Bollywood stereotypical bullshit, right? I mean,
understanding of South Indian is through North Indians.
Exactly.
They don't do it justice. They're like sub Madrasi, you know. So.
Precisely. Then I love that. I love that video, and rightfully so, it went viral. And one common thing with foreigners is like, they, whatever it is, right? Any human being in the world relates with sweets. And I think every foreigner immediately connects with Indian desserts, immediately, almost.
Especially Mexicans, because it's as equal. They love sugar so much. So even their sweets are like so sugary. So they're like immediately. A lot of sweets, conceptually, they are similar in the sense that they either have some type of milk or sugar base.
Mm.
So for them to eat them and realize the similarities between their sweets was really nice.
One thing is I always felt is that the closest thing to Indian food are Asian foods and Mexican food, because, you know, Mexicans have rajma, right? Mm-hmm. And they have taco, which is like chapati. We don't stuff chapati. They are stuffing chapati, basically. Asians eat a lot of rice recipes. What are the kinds of Indian foods that Mexicans or Asians connect with immediately in your experience? Apart from the dessert.
Asians, I would say the rest of the Asian countries besides South Asia, like Pakistan, India, like
East Asia. We're talking about East Asia, East Asian, basically.
East Asia, I would say, is completely different from India. Like the way they use, they don't use spices like we do. They don't have tomatoes like we do. But Mexican food is very similar to Indian food, because tomatoes and chili is one of the most important component of their food, which even for us, it is.
Basically chilies and tomatoes came from Mexico.
Portuguese bought it, right? I guess.
So basically Mexican food is like same but different.
Yeah, like they use chili powder and jeera powder and stuff the same way we do. There's a lot of potato. So it's very familiar, but the components are different. Like you would tear a roti and dip it into the sabji and eat, but here they would just put it inside, put the salsa on top, and then eat it like a taco.
Right. And having tasted Taco Bell here and like Mexican, what is that? California burrito. How do you feel going there? Because it's like tasting some random Madras cafe in New York and then coming to Chennai and actually tasting the real shit, right? Tell me the difference.
It's completely different. It's not at all like Mexican food. It's like eating, I can't even think of a nice
So basically Taco Bell and comparison. Burritos and everything are all from like North Mexico
or Tex-Mex.
All Tex-Mex.
Yeah, from Texas.
So they're not from like the rest of Mexico at all.
Yeah, so burritos and like the tortillas are made of corn.
How cute you say tortilla, right? It is tortilla. Come on.
No, it's tortilla. So where there's a double.
So what are you calling Jesus as Jesus? Come on.
No, but tortilla is they're made with corn, and they are come in so many colors. They're like here they have red corn, purple corn, blue corn. So and corn tortillas taste really different from the maida or like flour tortillas. So the cuisine in Mexico is like, you'll not get Mexican food, good Mexican food outside of Mexico unless it's being made by Mexicans.
Right.
So Taco Bell is like very junk. It's like eating McDonald's aloo tikki and saying, okay, aloo tikki sucks. You have to eat it in the streets of Delhi with all the chutneys and things like that, right?
Yes.
So Mexico is also similar to India in the sense that almost every state has a different unique cuisine.
Huh.
Like they will still have the corn tortillas, and north of Mexico has the flour tortillas,
right.
But they have like their own, based on what is growing in that region, they have different produce. Like south of Mexico is valleys and mountains, so they have like very good vegetables and fruits,
right?
And they have like good coffee and teas produced in the south of Mexico, but in the north it's very dry, so they eat cactus leaves. And cactus leaves are also like a very important snack with tacos. They make a chutney out of cactus leaves, and they serve with tacos. So there's some unique differences in the cuisine. Just like in India, every state differs slightly in what they are eating.
Yeah.
So it's nice to see that.
Yeah. And within the state also, it differs in a sense. But here's the thing. So what you're basically saying is, if an Indian comes to Mexico, he's just sorted. Like all the groceries that are available in India, his chili powder, haldi powder, that, this, everything is like chill. And not in an Indian grocery store. Like basically what Americans do is they go to a Gujju store and there they get shit, right? Yeah. Not like that in Mexico. You can actually go to proper Mexican grocery store owned by a Mexican guy. You can get all you want for your Indian dishes, in a sense.
Yeah, you can pretty much. Like all of the pepper, jeera, haldi, everything is easily available here. And people will, like, it's not like you have to go out of your way to find ingredients. Maybe for yellow dal you have to. Mm. But you get a green dal and a pink dal, which is, you can use it for Indian.
Mm. Tur dal, is it available? Because that's
no,
my favorite.
No. Oh. You have to go to the Indian store.
Right. Right.
So how, but they have other lentejas which you can like.
Yeah, they have other lentils. Yeah.
Mm. So lentejas is lentils.
Mm. So in the lockdown cooking that I have learned, I think dal is one thing that I have kind of got a hold of. So that's why I'm asking. But anyways, which one of you has a bigger buck? Like bigger bug? Like, so did anyone? Who was a reluctant travel bug? Who was an extroverted travel bug of you both? Who infected who, in a sense?
I mean, the thing is, like,
I didn't know like this kind of life was possible.
Yeah. So I basically already knew when I met her, like, this like kind of life was possible, and I really wanted to do it, and we connected over travel.
Yeah, I was a lawyer. So, I was working like 16 hours a day and eating cornflakes for dinner in the office, and I never thought you could just like work remote and stuff. I didn't know that was possible.
So I did introduce her that, okay, this kind of lifestyle is possible, but our interest in, like, if we compare, I don't think our interest in travel was like different.
Okay.
We both had the same levels of interest in traveling and exploring new places.
Probably we can say you had more experience than her in terms
of... Yeah, I had more experience because I had already done this, but not like we vary in interest.
We are
very curious about new places. We even today, that's what drives us. We want to go to new places because, like, we are like, okay, we have been in Mexico City for 8-9 months now. We have not stepped out of Mexico City. We are like, okay, we have to go somewhere. Like, this is the max limit of us not able to go to a new place. Basically, like, okay, it's time. We are itching to go somewhere.
Yeah.
So our curiosity has never...
Same. Yes.
So that curiosity is there. We want the curiosity satisfied every 3 months. And both of us feel that way. So, like, for example, I also really want to have a dog. We really love dogs and cats and stuff. Mm. But traveling with pets is not possible. So, so as much as we want a dog and need a dog, I guess, we really have to travel. So we
keep putting it off, like, at 35 or at 40 or at 45.
Right.
So there's no like difference in levels.
Yeah, we like the same things. We like meeting people, eating good food, exploring like little neighborhoods. So that way we are kind of similar, except he really wants to climb massive mountains. And I think if he says come with me, I will go, but I would like to see the mountain from a view somewhere. No, I don't want to.
But a lot of views in the world is like you have to climb somewhere to get the view.
No, you have to climb somewhere else to see the mountain. Like, I don't want to Mount Fuji, but maybe I want to climb somewhere else where I can see beautiful mountains.
I also don't want to climb Everest, but I would want to go to the base camp. So that requires still climbing. You could go in a helicopter, but that's no fun.
Okay, after this pandemic, we will climb one mountain. Okay, revenge climb.
Like, let's go to the volcano right beside Mexico City.
It was closed. Yeah, there's a volcano. It looks amazing. Like, it's stunning. But we went there and then there was one guard there. And he was like...
No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying the active one.
Yeah.
Not the dead one.
The Nevada was closed. So, and we are like, okay, the churches, movie theaters, everything in the city is open. And this volcano where there's going to be like 3 people, you've closed it. Yeah.
That is sad. And how important is... the spouse, right? Because for me, one of my biggest nightmares is, like, for me, my honeymoon plan, so-called plan, right? If I get married, right? It's like, I want to rent a caravan and go around Iceland, because me, Iceland is just freaking stunning. It's like straight out of a science fiction movie, very otherworldly, right? And I'm like, what if I get a spouse is like, bro, like, baby, I want hotel. I don't want to stay in tent. I want
so
toilet.
I feel like those are the differences which make or break a relationship, right?
Mm.
So maybe when this honeymoon plan has to be put into
action, that is just a very vague example. That is a very vague example, right? But you know what I'm saying?
That way, like the fundamental things we really connected with. If there's a time that we have to just sleep at an airport, we are fine with that. Mm-hmm. And sometimes if we want to splurge, okay, just let's live in a tree house or a resort in a, under a waterfall or whatever. We are like, okay, we can afford that this month. Let's try that. And sometimes we are like, oh, just one night. Let's stay in some shit hotel near the airport. That also works for us. So that way, we both are not picky about specific things that would be like, oh, she only wants this or he only wants that. We are very compatible that way. So that has never been a problem.
I mean, and also
sometimes I even like, okay, just book something. Don't even show me. Fine.
I mean, that's the thing, right? Like making plans, especially with a, for a partner, when the partner is not around, is not a good idea. In general,
but and I'm okay.
No, not like with us, but with the example you were saying, yeah. Like with stuff, like okay, that's a like, you shouldn't have any such plans. If you want to go in a caravan and go to Iceland, you go do it now.
Don't depend on something.
But there are some places I'm saving for my so-called would-be.
Yeah, sure.
So,
but don't put so much pressure on honeymoon. Maybe it's better to just kind of get to know each other really well, and then 5 years into the relationship, when then you just celebrate like, okay, let me do a dream trip like Antarctica.
I mean, that's the thing, right? You meet someone, you like someone, and you want to marry them, and but they love New York so much that I want to go to New York for honeymoon. Your honeymoon ideas are gone.
Yeah.
Right.
Fair point. So
you should not. Like make decisions on things which are not around. So if you really want to go to Iceland and go in a caravan, go.
Just right. Like,
or if you meet someone who also has such strong ideas about their own honeymoon, and she's like, Iceland, I want to go wherever.
Yeah,
so,
New York.
So and then maybe example. You like her enough to give in.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm like, ek tumhara, ek mera. One for you, one for me kind of thing then.
For example, Vietnam, I was not so keen to go the first time. I don't know why I was not. Mm. But he had already lived in Vietnam for 6 months. So he was like, come, you love it and stuff. So it took me a while to warm up to Vietnam. And then we are like, okay, no, I want to stay another 3 months, extend our visa. And then we were like, we ended up staying 6 months in Vietnam.
I was like, I was so excited to show Vietnam to her that I was overpowering. I wanted to show everything on day one. So that was overwhelming. But after a couple of days, I knew she would come around and like Vietnam.
It's impossible not to like. Yeah. I think we've liked pretty much every place we've been to except US.
Yeah.
Which is very strange.
It's not actually. If you're traveling for a long time, you will really feel that way about the US.
Let us put a disclaimer there saying that we are talking about US cities.
Yeah.
We have not been to the wilderness in the
US. Yeah, I'm sure that is amazing. Yeah.
Oh, you have not been to Grand Canyon, for example.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
the biggest reason is we don't know how to drive. So,
right. Oh, great. Okay.
So, that's a skill which we wanted to pick up in the pandemic. It hasn't happened. But we're sure we'll learn to drive and go back to the US and...
Motorbike, no?
I mean, in the US...
In the US, no. It's like 2 days to go anywhere. So, yeah, got it. Yeah.
So, even in Mexico, like, if we do get a motorbike, like, anywhere in Latin America, the only place in the places we have been to where motorbike is a big thing is in Colombia. Like, all you are like...
No wonder Pablo Escobar was crazy about motorcycles.
Yeah, did but you the, ever... the funny thing is, like, it's all our bikes.
Yeah, it's all TVS.
And... Bajaj. Like, Bajaj Pulsar. We hired a Pulsar in, like, basically in Colombia.
In Colombia?
Yes.
Wow. Don't tell me they had autos and Royal Enfield and shit
they
like
do.
That.
They do have
what
autos.
What the fuck, really?
Yeah, they have very nicely decorated autos. Yeah. So colorful painted
Bajaj
autos.
Bajaj has a huge presence in, like, Colombia. Basically.
But autos, we went on the Peru border, no? We had even to take Peru, an auto. Yeah.
But that's the thing, like in Mexico, it's more...
Share autos of 15 people in the auto hanging around. Really?
No, it's not share autos.
No, I'm just kidding. Yeah.
It's like, it looks like a helicopter because it has those doors which you have to pull close on each side.
Right.
Driver is also with like windows. So it's like a completely closed little submarine type. It's not like Indian.
I have seen those things in Chennai very rarely though.
Yeah.
But it's still made by Bajaj.
Yeah.
Wow.
So it's like it's a Bajaj auto.
Yeah.
But yeah, the in Mexico is more oriented towards the US. So it's more like towards cars and than in motorbikes. So hiring a motorbike here is painful.
Yeah, I guess it's very expensive, apparently.
Very expensive. Like, for example, if to hire a Pulsar 200cc or something, it's like about $70 a day.
A day.
Shit.
So if we rent it for a week, we might as well buy a bike.
Yeah. So, a day is like freaking EMI on some shit. Like,
But a car is like $13 a day.
Yeah.
Wow.
And cheaper now for the pandemic.
Like
because...
I'm not even taking $30. $13 a day for a car. For a bike, it's like $89 a day.
I think for them, bike is kind of like fancy, right? Like car is like shit. Anyone can have a car.
Yeah.
I think Mexico sounds like the USA of Latin American countries. Probably a little more wealthier than the others.
It's like the US, but better. Like, so US think of it like, if you want to be in the US, be in Mexico. So it's close enough. Like if I have family in many cities in the US and if I just want to go to LA or, you know, Dallas or something, it's very close. Round trip will cost me around $200 easily. So you can go to the US, you can, if you want to like go on a sightseeing shopping trip and come back. But Mexico has definitely a better quality of life than the US.
And
like I know people in the Indians living in the US will come for me, but like it's true. Mexico quality of life is so much better than the US.
Indians living in America are spending freaking $500 on an eye drop. It's not the case in Mexico. Because, like,
yeah, people come here to get their
exactly. medical work done. Yeah. I heard that. Medical tourism, right? But you were talking about climbing the mountain, right? By any chance, do you follow this guy called Casey Neistat? By any chance?
Of course.
Yeah.
Yes.
He climbed one mountain on his own.
Casey Neistat's sister is my friend.
Ooh.
And the company he consults for in the US, Casey Neistat is one of the board members. So he's met the founder of the company, of course. You can see the founder in Casey's vlogs. They go running together in New York a lot.
So there's this guy called Ben who comes up once in a while in Casey's vlogs.
I'm like, I wish I had mind-blowing emoji.
One degree of separation from...
Yeah,
I'm like blogging hero Casey Neistat.
My mind, like mind blown emojis are like coming out of my mind right now. You can just imagine that. But so if you're one separation away, I'm like four separations away from a podcast. I'm just kidding. he climbed one mountain. Have you seen that vlog? He climbed one mountain. It's in South America, I guess. You can go ahead and climb.
South Africa.
Did he do it in South?
Tanzania. It's in Tanzania.
Kilimanjaro.
Right. Have you been to Africa by any chance? Because that's not yet. Me too. But tell me this, like, which country did you start from as a couple?
Taiwan.
So we wanted to start from Bali because we knew that Bali has a very big nomad community. People like they have co-working spaces, co-living spaces. So
before you go ahead, how did this become this all of a sudden like this honeymoon spot for many Indians? How did that happen?
Because always a honeymoon spot,
and it's fairly affordable because all these villas, private pool villas, and all these are very easy to book in Bali.
Right.
So it's romantic, so I guess that's why.
Actually, there is a moment when it took off as a honeymoon spot. Eat, Pray, Love.
Yes, exactly. So the Eat, Pray, Love, May, the love part is in Bali.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, it's a great place to go to honeymoon also. But it's not a great place.
Ruchi, you were saying Bali?
Yeah, so Bali has this huge digital nomad community. Pockets of Thailand also have the digital nomad community. So we were thinking, let's go somewhere where we already know a couple of people. So it'll be nice. Transition will be nice.
Right.
People will just set us up with which cafes have the best Wi-Fi to work from. And you'll just have a nice group where you have similar things, right? Because a lot of Some of our good friends, they are very supportive of us, but some of our friends, we've just kind of fallen out because they simply cannot relate with what we are doing anymore.
Yeah, you couple in a Bangalore flat without sofas and a couple of plastic chairs, exactly. Sold everything. Obviously, no one will understand you.
I mean, a sofa is like, what, 50,000? Even a second-hand sofa is expensive. Even, I've seen on Urban Ladder sofa. The 50,000 is a trip to Bangkok.
Yeah, easy. That is exactly how I think. I own a shitty phone. I literally have cash to buy an iPhone right now. But for me, buying an iPhone is like, fuck, that's like three countries. That's how I think. That's my currency. My currency is countries.
Exactly, same. Like, I always tell my friends that, okay, an average weekend out in Bangalore, if you want to have a nice weekend, what will you do? You'll just, a couple of Ubers will cost you like close to $500. A nice dinner out with alcohol will cost you around 3,000, 4,000. Movie will cost you 1,200.
Yeah.
And any sort of cafe, hanging out in
cafes. If you eat extra popcorns in the movie theater, it'll cost you more.
Exactly.
Yeah.
If you just sell your sofa. Yeah, exactly. And a casual weekend can come up to almost 10,000. If you add shopping to that, even more, right? Because you feel like it's not expensive when you go into this H&M or Zara and you're like, okay, everything is like...
That is a Gokarna trip right there.
Yeah. So for us, it was always like, okay, do you want to eat Vietnamese food in Bangalore or do you just want to fly to Vietnam and eat it? And the cost really compares because on the street food in Vietnam, how much is it? Like it will be less than $5, a good meal.
$5?
Yeah.
It's like 100 rupees.
Yeah.
It's like $1.
Yeah, you can get two first and $100. And
funny thing is, Vietnamese street food in Vietnam may be costing you 200 rupees or something. Then here there will be some fancy Vietnamese restaurant charging fucking 800 for a plate for the same shit that you get on street, which is less tasty.
Exactly. Yeah. So if it was always like it just weighed out for us that the price always was like it's much cheaper to travel than to have like massive decorated houses or anything in Bangalore.
That actually makes sense.
I live in Indiranagar, paying like 30k rent when you can live in Vietnam or Bali or Phuket or something. You'll get a private villa with a beach, and maybe in Bali you'll definitely get a private pool. And like all your expenses come up to almost $250-$300.
Yeah, not
just rent. I'm taking
not for the private pool, but
No, private pool villas in Bali are like 300 a month.
No.
Yes.
Okay, maybe in the pandemic, but when we were there. It was definitely.
It was. We didn't look enough.
Okay. All right.
Wow.
So we wanted to go to.
Do you guys realize that you can open a travel consulting company and make money?
It's boring, man.
No, I'm just kidding. Go on. Sorry, in Bali.
So we wanted to go to Bali, but we got an opportunity from the Taiwan Tourism Board. They said that, why don't you come to Taiwan and do a video for, like, we'll show you around for 3 days.
Were you famous by then, like, by any chance, or how?
I mean,
how
we were, like 7K subscribers. No, 7K, like, followers on Instagram.
Where were you? This was your first travel, right? So how did you get? So you were traveling within India, is it?
We had already been to like a couple of places on our own, and we had already had a blog and Instagram.
Right.
No, but the main content was actually Goa.
Before we gave up our apartment, we thought we'll do a test run in Goa to see if what are the challenges and stuff, and if it doesn't work out, if we don't like it, we have our house in Bangalore, we come back.
I guess the story of it went viral, right? The fact that I saw your post, right? Somewhere in 2016, you wrote this big post like, yeah, we're selling. I think that must have went viral. And
that
must have went viral. And then people got invested in your story, like how will you pull off kind of thing, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So you went to Goa and this happened, and then Taiwan invited you. And then what happened?
So then Taiwan told us this will be a 3-day sponsored trip. And they'll take care of the tickets as well. So we're like, 3 days kaun jata hai travel, you know? We're like, just make it 30 days, whatever the visa allows, and we'll take care of our expenses for the rest of the trip.
Right.
So they were like, they were a bit hesitant because they're like, 30 days, what will you do 30 days in Taiwan? What is there to do? You just 3 to 4 days is enough. And we're like, no, we just want to stay for a month, just make it. And they all they had to do was book change our tickets the, a bit later. Date of date the ticket. Of the return ticket.
So basically we went to Taiwan and stayed there for 1 month.
Yeah.
And that's where our as the couple digital nomad journey started. Basically.
Right.
And we stayed in this co-living space.
Yeah.
Run by this this guy who used to run the LinkedIn of China.
Yeah. Because China has to have their own social network. So he was a founder of Chinese LinkedIn.
That's the rule in Taiwan also, is it? Like they use Chinese shit, right?
But he is a Taiwanese, so he came and opened a like co-living space in Taipei.
Right.
And that's where we stayed for 1 month in Taiwan.
Right.
And it was incredible. Taiwan was never in our list of places to go. And this was such a good opportunity which came our way. We love Taiwan now. We have friends there. We have gone multiple times to Taiwan.
If we don't know where to go in Asia and we just need to do a visa run, we'll just go to Taiwan.
Right.
Taiwan is like incredible.
Yeah.
Did you visit that building, Taipei 101? Right.
Yeah.
I remember watching its construction video on this Megastructures and Discovery channel. Yeah.
It's really nice to see the earthquake prevention,
The dampers and everything of the building.
Yeah, they have some stuff in their base kind of thing, right? Which prevents.
There's a counterweight on top, which is called a damper.
Yes, exactly. One big ball kind of thing. I remember that.
You can actually go see the ball.
Yeah.
Basically. Wow.
People touch it also.
Yeah. So we went there. We did all those things.
Amazing.
Yeah. Taiwan is a very, very, very unique place in the sense that it has the modernization and infrastructure of the first world.
Hmm.
But their cultures, their uniqueness of Taiwan is also it exists so beautifully, just like Japan. Yeah. Both culture and tradition exist together cohesively, not like getting in the way or something.
Right.
So it was a nice experience in that sense to have that as our first experience to the first world, then go to Europe or.
It is pretty evident, right? In that building itself, the Taipei 101, it kind of looks like their temple-ish design, right? The pagoda. Yeah. What do they call it? Pagoda? No.
Pagoda is Chinese, no?
Buddhist.
Yeah.
Buddhist, right. Okay. But the very building itself is designed in one of their traditional structuring kind of thing. It kind of reflects there. But now is not the right time to go to Taiwan because apparently China is pretty pissed. Lucky you. But tell me about what is the most weirdest, most exotic food you tried in any East Asian country, right? For example, I when you say Vietnam, right, I think of Vietnam. I was very recently watching this Vietnamese movie made by Spike Lee, where a bunch of US soldiers go to Vietnam to, you know, recover their friend's body or something. The Five Bloods is the name of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And they go to this floating markets in the boat, and, you know, people are freaking selling like freaking frogs and like snakes and shit. And the guy in the movie he holds a live snake. He's like, you want snake? He's offering, like, he's trying to sell his snake, right? He's like, you want snake? He just puts it, live snake. He just cuts his head, like, yo, this is it, fresh snake, please take it. That's the way he was selling, right? So did you tell me about those markets and like,
that's a Western stereotype.
Yeah, that's like
really
a major stereotype, because I think a lot of foreigners, they just want to see that version of Asia. Like, they want to see, okay, they eat bugs, they eat snakes.
Mm. Like, the thing is, like, we are not saying that those things are not there. They are there.
But
they are just like a small, like if you go to a
touristy place,
house,
they will offer you snake wine and stuff.
But if you go to a Vietnamese house, the food, they don't eat those things.
Yeah.
So the day in and day out food is completely.
It's not their staple food. It's more like an exotic.
Yeah. Like,
kind
for
of.
Example, if the stereotypical version of India for foreigners, especially white people, is like do yoga and everything is orange and yellow. We play Holi on the street all the time, and the stereotypical vision is Rajasthan, basically. Rajasthan, Agra, Kerala, that's India for them. So if you see a city like Bombay or Bangalore, see the startup revolution, the culture, young people just being normal, for them it's like that's not India. They want to sit on a houseboat playing Holi at the same time.
So
drinking out of coconuts, petting a cow.
Yeah. Back to Vietnam. This funny thing is, like, when I was in Vietnam, I was a vegetarian. I was born vegetarian. So when we started this journey initially, I was a vegetarian.
But he's the type of vegetarian who would eat the gravy and the sides.
No, wait, you
could eat broths.
No, I like until
like
I
like you would taste it, but you would
until
not.
Until I met you, I didn't drink broths.
So I did it.
Yeah. But it's funny that Vietnam has, people consider Vietnam with snakes and stuff, but it's like one of the countries where you can be actually a vegetarian, like you can be in India.
Like completely vegan also.
You can be complete vegan and local food.
Yeah.
Not like some random shit, vegan cafe shit. Like day in and day out, people are vegan in Vietnam, like in India, because they cannot also afford meat every day.
Yeah,
right.
So, meat is like a sign of prosperity. It's expensive.
So day in and day out, they are also vegetarian. So they are Buddhist influencers, where a sect of people of Vietnam are vegetarians all the time, or vegans all the time. But all Vietnamese on certain days of the month are vegans. So
especially the Buddhist.
I mean, every Vietnamese is basically
pretty much
on those days they don't eat meat. So
like Saturday, Sunday shit like us though.
Exactly. Yeah.
Something like that.
But some people are like completely vegan.
Yeah.
They don't eat.
So there is infrastructure.
And a huge community. It's not like a small sect of people is vegan. A huge community is vegan. So you find vegan food
everywhere. Like in
you mean vegan, not even milk. Vegan literally means that.
Yes, exactly. There's no concept of vegetarianism in many Vietnamese foods. It's either vegan or non-veg.
Ah.
So if they don't want to use animal products, they're not going to use milk and butter. And
right. And these are the kind... Sorry, go on.
No, the point I was trying to make is like... like we feel like we'll eat weird food, but you'll end up eating amazing vegetarian, vegan... Vietnamese food. It's not like some random salad I will make because it's vegan. You can get pho in the vegan version of pho and vegan version of banh mi. Like you can take any Vietnamese dish, you get a vegan version, not made because it's I want to be vegan now, but it's like culturally there.
In fact, the concept of vegan meat originated in ancient China.
Vegan meat.
Yeah, they make meat out of soy and tofu, mushroom. It's like, it looks like chicken or beef, but it, of course, it's made out of soy.
But yeah, what's the most weird food you have eaten?
Weird food. I ate ice cream with coriander. That was very nice. I love that.
I've eaten ice cream with salt at the same place, right?
Yeah.
And
the worms.
Yeah, the worms.
They're like crickets, small worms in Mexico. And they are fried with salt and chili. It's just like eating some snack, like fried peanuts or something. And when we landed in Mexico, our friend is like, this is tradition. You must eat the worms. So we took a shot of mezcal and we ate the worms.
But we usually don't like go after like weird things. We just like eat what the locals eat.
Like if I don't know it is something weird and my like reflexes are up, I can eat it. Like if don't tell me after, but don't tell me before eating, you're eating tail or nails or whatever. I don't want to know.
You did eat chicken feet though.
Chicken feet is yummy. It's cartilage, so it's really good.
These are the kind of things you will know when you stay at a place for months, right? Not the kind of things you'll know when you go for a week or two, right? Yeah. That's not going to happen. Is that why you stay for 3 months? I mean,
we really enjoy the whole, like, just stay for 3 months. And of course, you cannot claim to know what the locals do in 3 months because that is their life there.
I mean,
and
there's two extremes, right? You can go and stay, do as a tourist for a week and come back. And then there's this new trend like, oh, stay like a local. But of course, you are not a local. You'll never be a local unless you start to experience the bad things of the place.
Yeah.
We will basically go there and stay for 3 months and only experience the good things.
Yeah.
You still understand the local culture and everything, but it's always the good side of things.
Yeah, you're just empathizing and talking with the locals and knowing what they hate about their city. But you, until you live long enough and get caught in the bureaucracy of that
and
city,
politics of the country,
until that affects you, you are still a tourist. You are very privileged. You live in, like, for example, for us, we have the finances and just we are at least privileged enough that wherever we go, we choose like whatever neighborhood we like. If we like one of the posh neighborhoods, we'll be like, huh, we can stay here for 2-3 months.
Right.
So you don't really, you can hear about the struggles, you can read about it, but you don't really know the struggles of the locals unless you feel it yourself.
Your point reminds me of a point that my aunt had made when her sister-in-law stays in US and his kid is US-born Desi guy, US-born US citizen. He's like, I'm bringing over my friends to India, right? He brought his friends over to India and they had fun. They went back and they were like, yeah, we loved India, that, this. And then when my aunt very wisely said, they're like, उनको क्या मालूम वो आको चले जाती उनको क्या मालूम यहाँ आको आको गए तो अच्छा रहता आई होप यू अंडरस्टैंड राइट
एग्जैक्टली Like you are privileged until the politics and bureaucracy of the country hits you. Then you right. know what it's like.
So the point is like, even if we stay for 3 months in a place, we are still tourists. We accept that. And we know that's our privilege now that we can move on from that place. But staying there for 3 months does give us insights into the society more than like going there for like...
A lot better than the people who go there for a week, for sure. For yeah, sure. Exactly. Obviously.
So we don't have like any massive itinerary or list like you have to do these things or some things you have to do. Like, for example, if you go to Paris, you have to see the Eiffel Tower. Or if yeah. you go to Peru, you have to see
Machu Basics.
Machu. Yeah. Some important things that are, they are famous for a reason.
Yeah, we don't believe in that narrative that, okay, off-peat travel is the best travel.
Yeah. Whatever you want to do is like, the best for you.
So there is a narrative going around saying like, okay,
leave the cities.
Why do you want to go?
Yeah, leave the famous places.
Exactly.
Which is nonsense.
No, the point is like they are famous for a reason. Yes, yeah. you go there and you see a lot of people. And
yeah, this is the classic case of being different for the sake of being different.
Yeah, exactly.
So you, I mean, Eiffel Tower is beautiful. You can go there.
And it is a like marvel of architecture. You yeah. must see it.
Yeah.
Especially if you are interested in architecture.
Yeah. And also like if you go there, if you see it and then decide you didn't like this place, that's different. That's okay. But you have to have the open mind to do that. You can't just skip completely and go to a random village in Colombia and say, okay, I've done it.
I don't travel like tourists.
Yeah,
I'm a traveler.
So yeah, we are very different that way. Our thinking is completely
yeah.
different.
We just kind of see some of the important things which we have in mind that a place is known for that we want to see. And the rest of the time we are like, okay, let's just walk around and see whatever.
Yeah. I think what so you're getting to 30% predetermination, 70% yeah. just free will.
Yeah. Planned spontaneity. So little bit is spontaneous, little bit is planned. So like, for example, if you just come to a city and then you join a gym or join a like a yoga class or something, or go to like a pottery class or something, you will definitely meet some people, and especially locals. So the goal is to have a balance of meeting locals and other travelers. So if you stay in a hostel or hotel, you will meet other travelers like you.
Yeah.
So people say, oh, I've stayed in a hostel, but I made so many friends while traveling. But you're not making local friends who live there who can give you a good insight into the culture. You're just meeting travelers like you who are also going to leave. So we feel that there should be a nice mix of meeting foreigners and locals.
Locals outside of the tourism industry.
Yeah, exactly. So they're not going to push you to some nonsense.
Like, is there in the tourism industry and service industry, they are there to, I mean, they're not, some people are nice people, some people are their agenda and everything, but you still have to go meet people who are outside the industry.
Yeah. So you just ask them, okay, where do you celebrate your birthday? Where would you go to celebrate something important? And then they'll tell you the place where not a lot of people would otherwise know, which you wouldn't read about in a blog or something.
So but the tourist guy will tell you the hotel that he has a commission from.
Exactly. I mean, we are not saying all tourist industry people are like this. There are very genuine people.
Yeah.
A lot of our very good friends we make are from the tourism industry or restaurant industry, because
we work out of cafes. So after
cafe owners are the best friends.
And if you like a cafe, we obviously go there at least 3 to 4 times a week. So
you get to
the cafe owners always like, what are you guys doing? So we always start chatting with the cafe owners.
There is no such culture in India, right? Sadly, because, you know, the is there a cafe culture in India? Because sadly, there was one time I had to do this important podcast with very important guy and there was no power. And I just could not, it could not strike to my mind, where can I do this, right? I just could not figure out, right?
You can't work in cafes in India because one is our problem. Every Indian problem comes down to there's so many people.
Yeah.
That's like the first cause of every problem in India. But I feel like the cafe culture that is there in other countries is absent in India. I don't know why. But like, for example, knowing that, okay, if I'm going to sit in this cafe for 6 hours, maybe every 1 hour I'll order something, or maybe I will
courtesy move
to another cafe or something like that. So, or I'll not take big Zoom calls or phone calls, or I'll not have a big group of... There are different cafes abroad that we have seen where people have a group and they are hanging out with friends. Mm. And there are different cafes where people work from. So people have this etiquette in mind, which is not present in India that I have seen.
Right. And it's you speak of Vietnam, right? Because again, you speak of privilege, you speak of Vietnam, because I was in Thailand airport one day and I just, there was this guy from Scandinavia, I guess, some Scandinavian country. And then he's like, bro, I asked him for a charger. So we started chatting and he was like, bro, I'm going to go to Vietnam. I'm going to stay for like 3 months. I'm like, what? I'm like, it just didn't register in my mind, right? Because I was on this weird Thailand trip where I went to Thailand the day the king of the Thailand died in 2016.
Bad time.
Yeah, because it is apparently illegal. You can go to jail if you talk shit about king in Thailand.
If you, right? Because the currency notes have the king and queen on them. If you crumple up the currency notes and shove it into your pocket, they look at you like, okay, what is wrong with you? Indians don't do that because we think money is God, right? So we treat paper currency in a better way.
Might have probably done that.
Yeah, it's not illegal, but they will be offended.
Taboo.
Yeah, it's a big taboo.
Yeah, and everyone was like so sad. I mean, the vibe of the whole place just went down. And
I think we were also there when the king died.
I don't remember.
Now.
Very
popular.
I'm talking about the previous king itself.
When he died.
And the queen has done so much for the community. She does a lot of charity and stuff.
Yeah, I'm like, everything is closed. I'm like people are like, dude, you didn't have fun in Thailand. I'm like, bro, and you imagine it reminded me of the time when my chief minister of my state, Rajshekhar Reddy, died. And when I was in Andhra, every channel was just so sad. I mean, the song and the ad hoardings were full of king, and the song and the music, it just... Everyone was crying. I don't know how many were pretending, for example. But yeah. But, you know, there was this guy and I was like, because I was just a tourist, right? It didn't register to my mind like, okay, this guy is going to a different country, renting the place, staying for 3 months. I'm like, bro, tera paisa kahan se aata hai? What do you do? I'm like, I was so curious. And that is exactly why your vlog really fascinated me, because there are very, very less Indians who live like what you live like.
I mean, I don't think we have met any Indians.
I mean,
really?
How many have
like Tirumal?
Yes.
Two people
we have met.
We basically have known like 4 to 5 people who do this full time like us, Indian. Most of them are part time and rarely, like, I mean, there are another couple. But
the entire Avinasha, the entire humanity is part time traveling. Come on.
None of them whom we have met are couples, like
they don't have Indian girlfriends.
They
have like partners from somewhere else.
Classic.
One of our Indian friends who we met in Mexico, he has been doing this for almost 5-6 years now. 10 years maybe.
Wow,
not 10 years.
He worked in the US and then he saved up enough money to do this, and then while traveling in Philippines, he met a girl, so now they travel together.
You would have ended up in his
in his blog at some
it's
point.
Called visatraveler.com.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I think he was in your video. I guess he was in your video. Right. Yeah. Oh, that sounds like a nice podcast.
He was in the
He was in the South Indian video, right?
Yeah, so one of our friends, he is a Goan, and you barely meet many Goans out of India, so that itself is really nice. And he's a college dropout or a high school dropout. Yeah, and he just travels, he makes money online as well. He does some sort of website building consultancy, something.
He's mainly a SEO guy.
Yeah.
He does search engine optimization.
Because
at 18, he dropped off and started working in SEO. And like he has worked with big brands in SEO. And now he consults. So he travels.
Yeah.
I mean, you are doing what Christopher Nolan was trying to do in Inception with the hero, right? You're planting me ideas, okay? So I'm like, okay, if I'm working from my grandmother's place, why can't I work from Vietnam? Why can't I work from like freaking...
Italy. Vietnam is cheaper than... Believe
yeah, me. No, Italy is just out of budget because if they pay in euros, I'll work in Italy, right?
No,
the goal is to get money from a source independent of your travels.
So,
if your company is Indian and you're getting money like in rupees in India, and then you go to whichever country in your budget and your like preferences you like, if you like the beach or the mountains or whatever in your budget, Asia is great because Asia is very budget friendly and
the flights are cheap.
Visa is pretty easy. Like Europe and all, you can't just get a 1 month visa straight off.
I'm not talking about white countries. Forget about them. I'm just talking about,
nearby, or even India itself. Like I would love to go explore Goa and Northeast and Kerala and stuff. But the thing is, when we started, Goa had terrible Wi-Fi. Like besides punching, we couldn't even take our calls and stuff like that.
So we couldn't do the same thing what we are doing now in India when we started, but we hear the situation has improved a lot now.
Right. Let's just for 5 minutes, just plan a fun trip for a guy who's working from home, IT guy from Bangalore. I'm like, forget, vacate your house. You will get advance if your owner is kind enough. Freaking 70,000-80,000
bucks. Yes, our owner was so nice. He gave us our whole deposit back. He didn't even keep for like the painting, whatever they did. He was like, you guys have not made even one scratch on the wall.
Yeah.
I mean, there was no furniture.
Because everything was like, there was nothing in the house.
Yeah.
And you don't play cricket in the house. So, yeah. If a Bangalore guy can just quit his job, you'll get at least 40K in your hand. The hell with going to your mom's place, the hell with going to your grandmom's place. You must have spent time, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. Now take that money. So book a flight to freaking Vietnam, cost you like 20,000 bucks, maybe. Right.
Yeah.
And then work from Vietnam 9 to 5 as in they'll be ahead, like what, 3 hours ahead. So freaking wake up early a little.
So, that like for as a freelancer, we don't have to worry about that. We can just work at any time.
Asia.
So we usually like Monday to Thursday. And sometimes we like to do get up early and finish it off so that by 4 o'clock we are free to.
No, I'm talking about an IT guy who can literally replicate his schedule, right?
Indian
what? Yeah, 9 to 6. 9 to 6 in Vietnam's language is like what? 12 to.
Yeah.
No, it's just 1.5 hours.
Yeah.
11 to 7 or whatever, right? Okay. So.
Yeah.
That's it.
Cool. Yeah.
No, roughly around there. Basically, Indians don't really work from 9 to 6. Let's be honest; they work from 11 to 8. Who wakes up at 9, right? Like, come on. Yeah, and you will get your salary, which is like Vietnamese equivalent. I guess Vietnamese is what, 2 rupees? I don't know. 2 rupees per 1 rupee. I don't know the conversion roughly.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's like you're getting 50,000 bucks in India. You'll get fucking 1 lakh in Vietnamese money. 1 lakh is pretty good money, right? You have weekends. Stay there for a couple of months. Rent will be cheaper than fucking Indranagar or shit, right?
Definitely. We had such a nice apartment in like the great part of the city for like...
Which city are you talking about? Hanoi? Saigon. Okay. Saigon is in the southern Vietnam.
Yeah.
Hanoi is in the north one.
Yeah. Hanoi is the capital. Yes, in the north.
Right.
So tourists like Hanoi, but people who stay long and people who like to like digital nomads or long-term travelers, they like Saigon. So you'll, because Hanoi has that typical Vietnamese vibe of like, oh, you want to see some communist style Vietnam and you want to see those busy markets.
Yeah, do you really think there's a difference between the north and the south? Because, you know, Hanoi versus Saigon, because, you know, that was the Vietnamese war separation, right? That was the separation, the history.
Saigon is super chill. Most South Vietnamese people are very friendly with Americans. Even after the war, they have this, now they have this connection.
Yeah.
Of course, after the war, it cannot be erased. So Americans are feel very welcome in Vietnam now.
Right.
And they're doing a lot of things, like they're bringing about a nice startup culture and stuff like that. And so Saigon, I feel, is the place to be if I were to be in Vietnam.
So if a bank... Sorry, go on.
I was coming back to an IT guy going there.
So I was actually coming back to that. So, okay. So the rent is solved. Salary is resolved. Okay. Timings are resolved. What else? Food. Okay. Food. So now you talk about food.
If the type of person who like cannot eat Vietnamese food and only has to eat Indian food, like once a week he can eat Vietnamese, but the rest of the time he has to survive on Indian or pizza, then it's, if you're eating Indian food outside, it's going to be, because they get ingredients and stuff. Restaurant Indian food is only North Indian food.
Yeah.
And if you eat that every day, you'll die.
Right. They'll be fucked. I'm guessing there will be rice. There will be chilies. They will be having some dry chilies.
Yeah,
right?
Vegetables are so easy to buy.
Yeah.
And you can just, if we like, we cook a lot at home and we really like cooking Asian food because that's like our favorite. That's
right.
We feel like the protein to carb balance is there when there is Asian food, but in Indian food is like dal is also carb, rice is also carb.
Yeah,
and if we eat that for lunch and then we eat curd rice, we are not working that day.
Right. Yeah, so, exactly.
So we really mindful of what we eat.
So for a single person bachelor, you can find studio apartments in Vietnam with a kitchen for about $350 a night, $350 a month. Okay. And then you basically your daily expenses will be barely around like $10.
Yeah.
Like it'll not be more than that.
Yeah. Right. Just eat something simple on the street.
Yeah.
Like street food is, so what happens in Vietnam is,
or if you even cook.
In a lot of places in Vietnam, what they do is there are restaurants, of course,
right,
and there are these little, what happens is it's a house and the family cooking for like a lot of people live in joint families. So they're cooking for 10 people and Vietnamese food is very suitable to be cooked in bulk. So if you're making a soup, and you just add the bones, simmer it for 8 hours. And why make little bit when you're cooking for 8 hours? Make it for like 30, 40 people. So a lot of the places are houses and the living room part is just a little restaurant where you can come and take away the food or just eat there if there is space.
Right.
So it's like exactly like home food. It's not, it doesn't have that fried restaurant feel where you might get sick. So for us, eating like that was really convenient.
Wow. So irrespective of how you eat it, how you eat, like if you're going to cook or if you're going to go eat outside, not exotic food like Indian food, but local food.
Yeah.
If you basically, you can basically be done with $300.
Yeah.
Right.
So $600 to $700, you can live for a month very nicely.
Comfortably.
Very
comfortably.
Yeah.
And
your salary must be $1,000 in software, assuming, right? So that, yeah. Oh my God, you can spend half on living, half on travel. Sorted, bro.
Yeah. And even travel is not that expensive. Like there's buses, which are super cheap. You can rent bikes and petrol is also fairly cheap.
And the traffic is very Indian. I have seen videos. The traffic is mad.
That's way more, methodical than Indian.
Yeah.
They don't have traffic signals in major city junction, apparently.
They do.
And
there is no. So in a traffic signal in India, there are 4 traffic signals, right? So for each road which is joining the intersection. But in Vietnam, there is only 2. There's 2 directions.
Right.
So both the traffic from both sides start off with 1 signal change. So if you want to take a right, you have to go through the oncoming traffic. But it's very methodical. Like people are very used to it. I mean, I was driven everywhere in Vietnam. Like we went on a
massive road trip, like
South Vietnamese road trip on a bike. So it's fantastic.
Yeah. That must be mad.
Yeah, the bike will only cost you what $50 a month.
Yeah.
That is sorted. Like, forget
to rent for you, then it's even cheaper.
Yeah, I mean that was $50.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, otherwise it's like $100.
Yeah.
That is just sorted. That is, you know, your taxi expenses are like gone. $50 is peanuts.
That, exactly. Yeah. So my question now is like, why are we back?
Yeah.
Oh my. You know what? You guys are like spoiling me right now. You know what? I don't know.
But yeah, most of the Asian countries, Southeast Asian countries are like this. Mm. Yeah, Thailand is a little bit more expensive.
Yeah.
Cambodia is cheap. Vietnam is cheap. Bali, if you don't stay in Bali, it's cheap.
No, Indonesia, I'll save it for the spouse. If there's a working from home spouse or something like that. I'm just kidding.
No, that's the thing. Everybody wants to go to Bali, but Bali is very tiny when compared to what is Indonesia is.
Yeah.
So you can go wherever in Indonesia. That's also cheap.
Right.
These are the spots to go for budget. And once you have gone there, worked your way up and start making more money, you can look into like Taiwan and Korea. And then you can come, if you can afford three times of India, then you can come to Latin America.
Right. Those freaks who work at Google and shit like that, they can go to Latin America and work. But I'm talking about this Bangalore guy. Okay, so, you know this famous phrase, when all of this is over, when the corona is over, what will you do? Corona is over, right? So when corona is over, assuming you'll have work from home intact, I think work from home will stay. So I'm like, yeah, 3 months, 1 month in Vietnam, 1 month in Cambodia. You suggest me one more country. I think, how is Laos? Is Laos over there?
Laos has a lot of internet problems here.
Oh, right. So Vietnam.
Thailand, like south of Thailand, even north of Thailand, which is not Bangkok. And like tiny towns.
But Bangkok's also amazing. It's expensive.
It's expensive.
Yeah, expensive. Yeah.
So like for us, we have worked our way up now to a level where we can afford Bangkok for sure.
Right.
But when we started out, of course, we didn't have that kind of money.
Yeah, like we want to be in a place where we have savings, and we have savings which we will not touch.
Right.
And emergency fund just in case you have to fly back to India, or you have to get like if something happened and you have to pay money immediately for a hospital or something.
Correct.
So you have to make sure that you have that backup and you're not just...
Or travel insurance.
Yeah, like how exactly your life would be in India.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Like you have a set of friends and family that you can ask for help if necessary. And you have like backups.
One month Vietnam, 1 month Cambodia, and then go to the land of Pablo Escobar. I'm not trying to glorify Pablo Escobar. He's an asshole, right? But it's just this narco fantasy, right? Talk about Colombia, right? You said autos, you said bikes. It doesn't look too expensive to me, in my eyes.
I mean, the only difference is the cost of living is three times India.
Yeah.
So like if you go buy Coke or coffee, it's three times India. So
right.
It's not still the white countries, but it's not like Southeast Asia and India.
Right.
You need to be able to afford three times your current expenses.
Right. And is it safe, Colombia? Is it safe now? Because it was very once safe. Upon a time, it's like the crime capital of,
there is a little bit. And the most that will happen to you, unless you get involved in some really sketchy thing, like going to like a lot of people come there for either drugs or hookers.
Yeah.
And if you do that, you obviously get into a wrong crowd if they see that you have money.
Right.
But if you're just a tourist, it's very chill.
Uh-huh.
Like a lot of solo female travelers have said that they were not that comfortable in Colombia, but that could just be like certain incidents.
And we people can blend in Latin America, right? Because we kind
of... Exactly.
Yeah.
And like here, they they think I'm Mexican, especially if I wear like a Mexican top or something. They just start talking to me in Spanish. Him, they can tell, okay, he's a little bit not Mexican looking, but me, they'll be like, and I have to tell them, no, I only know till the first sentence. After that, you have to speak in English.
Ruchika de Santos.
my Maria. Spanish name is Maria.
Oh. And
his Spanish name, because his name is Avi.
Jesus.
Javier.
Oh, right.
Because if I go to Starbucks, if I say Avi, they will write Javi. Because they know Javier.
Right. So they don't have a J in their language.
J is her.
Yeah. Jesus. That's what because there was this one guy, I don't know. There was this guy from Venezuela who settled in US who came with my cousin. I totally forgot his name. I don't remember. It was starting with J, but we all called him J. But he was apparently heavier or something like that. But I'm very curious about Colombia. Did you visit one of those old Pablo Escobar bungalows and shit like that? I can't help myself but bring to Narcos
so we
again.
We didn't because a lot of locals, they don't want Colombia to be associated with Escobar anymore.
I mean,
so
Medellin specifically.
Yeah. So
Medellin.
Medellin
is J in Colombia. Right. So, Medellin. Okay. Right.
Yeah, but double L is Y. Like tortilla is. I mean, Y in Mexico.
In certain places, double L is Y. In certain places, double L is J.
Mm.
So Medellin, but tortilla. Yeah, mm-hmm. That's a good way to
say it. Oh, that's his Medellin cartel. That's his cartel.
Yeah.
Right.
That's where he was.
Yeah, and that's where his home where he was killed is also there.
Right.
But locals really discourage tourism.
So there's a lot of tours where you can go and basically see all of
Puerto. I know, obviously. Can you believe there are tours for like Chernobyl, for example? Have you seen the show Chernobyl?
Yeah.
They have tours to that radioactive site. I'm like, dude, capitalism can just go and can do anything, right? Yeah. It's like it can capitalize any fucking thing.
As Ruchi was saying, the locals don't like it. They don't want to promote. So we decided.
And this money is still kind of going to the people involved, right? Like Escobar's family, like his son runs the tours and other people who were definitely involved in the drug trade previously are still making money openly from the tourism of the drug trade. So they really don't want
Are you safe to say things like this? Like, come on.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
So they don't like it when. Then you do that.
Yeah,
so
fair point. Because it's like foreigners coming to India and going to Dharavi for tourism. Like, what the fuck?
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Like, stop.
Slumdog millionaire tourism, you know? Yeah.
Exactly. So we want to show you the good things of India. We have so much to show, of course. Yeah. Like, any direction you go in India, there's so much new to explore, but people really want to see poor kids on the street and it's just sad.
So,
because that's a stereotypical view that they have.
Yeah. So it's funny that like Medellin has changed so much in the last one decade. Now it's basically the startup hub. It is basically the digital nomad hub. And all the areas which were like completely... there's an area called Colonia 13.
Right.
So it was like the hotspot for drug. And it's completely transformed now into like locals have taken up. It's not just the government doing it. Locals have taken up into their own hands to transform these places. So you would rather like go see those things rather than just.
And go to a place like that and catch hold of a guy who lived there for like 20, 30 years and saw it transform. Right. He'll have stories worth of a podcast.
Yeah. So we met someone like that and he was like, he's seen so many kids get kidnapped to just be taken to the drug trade and he's seen like kids killed and stuff and he's like, now it's so much safer now, I don't feel that fear for young people anymore.
I mean, it was incredible to see how Medellin has transformed.
Yeah,
I mean, just 10 years, it's not as though it has taken like 50 years. In 10 years the city has completely transformed,
right? And
Bogota is one of the coolest capital cities. I would just go back to Bogota in an instant. It's like everything that you hear about places like LA and New York, that, oh, look, it has these unique neighborhoods or it has like every neighborhood is distinct in looks and the culture and the feel of it. So I felt that way in Bogota. It's really a beautiful city. It's built into the mountains. Mm. So when you want to go, like when you want to go to the mountains, it's just like a 20-minute ride away.
Right.
So you don't have to be like, okay, for mountains, you have to just go on a 3-day trip outside the city.
Mm. That way, it's very similar to Mexico City.
Yeah, it's a beautiful, visually such a beautiful
city. So Bogota and Mexico have a lot of Nandi Hills, basically. We only have one Nandi Hills in Bangalore. Right.
The only difference is like we are at 2,500 meters. And Bangalore is at 800 meters.
Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Right. That altitude problem is also there. And one more thing, it's like some of you have your own bucket list. I have my own bucket list, right? Like I would love to visit Norway, for example, mm-hmm. Norway, New Zealand, because they're just stunning, right? Iceland. And I got these places got added into my bucket list because I saw someone go there. One of my seniors, I saw their pictures, I saw their descriptions, and you folks are adding more to my bucket list, actually, because, you know, Vietnam was not, I mean, I have this weird bucket list, I'm kind of a history nut, in a sense. I would like to visit places where important shit happened. Like, for example, I would like to visit the World War II spots, for example, right? Concentration camps and stuff like that. And Vietnam for historical reasons, again, you know, Vietnam War and, you know, stuff like that. But, you know, you guys are like genuinely adding me places to my bucket list. So I'm like, yeah, I was never really fascinated about Latin America. Let's be honest. I mean, the only place in South America I wanted to visit was Rio. That's the only place I was like kind of, you know, interested. But yeah, thank you for that. And I'm one more.
If you're into nature.
Argentina and Chile.
One place you have to add is Bolivia.
Oh my God, Bolivia just blew our minds.
I think you're reading my mind because that was my next topic. Sorry, go on.
It is stunning. Like Bolivia, you just go to La Paz, you land there, get used to the altitude. We were used to the altitude because we spent 2 months in Peru previously. Mm. And then La Paz is also a very unique city. There are no tourists because everyone just goes to the salt flats immediately as soon as they land in Bolivia. Yeah. So La Paz is like, they had not even seen Indians before. Everybody would ask like, India, and they would be like, oh, Indo, where is that? And
no, not where is that, but...
But a lot of people ask, where is that?
Yeah, but most like, the thing is like, everybody knows Indians, but they've never met an Indian.
Yeah. Mm. And like a lot of places like Mexico and all, Bollywood is so popular, but...
Huh, interesting. Interesting. And I was just so jealous when I saw your picture on the salt flats. And that those are they the most stunning salt flats in the world? Because I can't
they're
imagine.
The only one we've been to, so.
Yeah, they're the biggest. So.
Right.
And there's nothing around. Like, it's so surreal. There's no petrol bunk. There's if you take a car, you have to take like big gallons of petrol on top of the car. Mm. There is, and if you just want to eat, we just, there's no restaurants, there's no houses, absolute wilderness. Like imagine it's driving on another planet. And if we decide, okay, the views are nice, let's stop and eat here. So we have like, we stop the car, we have foldable tables and chairs, and we have like a gas stove, and then we cook our meals wherever we want to. It's an incredible experience. Like, and we were there for like almost 8 days. We were driving through the wilderness, no cell phones, no connectivity, not even like if you stop at a one of those hotels that they have built for tourists, there is no Wi-Fi. So we didn't know what's going on in the world. And then we just stepped out of the salt flats into the city. And then we're like, oh, this Corona thing. And we've got like so many messages, people asking us, where are you? Are you planning to fly back? And yeah. If we had done that 1 week later, we would have been stuck in Bolivia.
Instead of Mexico.
Yeah.
Right.
But yeah, like the one thing which struck me was like, I've not been to the wilderness part of the US. Mm. So I can't comment on that. But Bolivia was pure nature.
Yeah.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
And it's all happening at 4,000.
Like all these llamas running past. It's so beautiful to see.
It's incredible. Like it's one of, if you're into nature and trekking and stuff, you have to include Bolivia.
Right. And
we were planning to go again. Like we were thinking we'll just wait for 1 month and then go to the salt flats again because we just extended our Bolivian visa. So, but we had to like come back.
Yeah, these South Americans should get together like Europe and like do some, you know, some Latin visa will be like so nice. No, I always think about it.
US visa. US and visa is the Latin visa.
Bolivia is not on terms with the US, right? Bolivia. So there is no US influence in Bolivia. There are no fast food giants or any US companies. It's completely free of any other country's influence. It's a it's a very unique country. There's a lot of French people descended in Bolivia, like old French people who are married with the locals, and now the kids are half French.
So was so must have been some sort of a French colony, is it? I mean, I'm not sure of the history though.
It's maybe not even a French colony. Hmm. It's just that their exposure. It looks like after they got the independence, there was a bilateral agreement with France.
Right.
There was a lot of movement from between France and Bolivia.
Hmm. Yeah.
Because it was all basically Spanish. This was completely Spanish conquest.
And the border. Yeah, sorry, go on.
Yeah, the border.
I think the border of Peru and Argentina is like one giant Ladakh, isn't it?
Not Peru and Argentina. The Peru and Chile.
Chile and Argentina. No. Chile, is it? No. Bolivia sorry.
Bolivia and Argentina.
Yes. That's where the empanadas come from Saltenia.
The South Andes, where does it start? I thought it was, what was this? So this is Argentina is on the east. What is this thin country in the west? Is it Chile?
Yeah.
Right. I thought the South Andes, right? I think that entire idea, is it the driest place in the world or something like that? No rainfall since like...
Atacama is the driest
place. Atacama Desert. That is the name I'm looking for. You've been there?
That's on the other side of Bolivia. He has been there. I have been there. Because
right.
I went to Chile. That's when that was the first place I went to.
Right.
So Chile is also beautiful. It's incredible with nature.
Mm.
But like I like the Bolivia side of the desert, cold desert.
Right.
The Chile side is more developed. There's a lot of small towns and roads and everything.
Mm-hmm.
But the Bolivia side is completely wild. So.
Right. And did you touch any Amazon part anywhere in any country?
I mean, we were in countries where we were in Amazon was there. We were in Peru. We were in. Colombia.
You didn't get go into the jungle. You didn't go into the jungle.
You didn't get the chance to go to the jungle.
Can I add one city to your bucket list? So there is this city called Amazonas. I don't know. You must have heard about it.
Right?
Yeah, right in the center of Amazon. There is no road to that city, apparently. Because it's just so much forest surrounding it. So apparently that's the best like city to start from to explore Amazon.
Yeah.
And one more thing. I mean, you have added so much to my bucket list. Let me add a few, right? Have you ever thought about Central Asia, for example, Mongolia?
Yeah.
The steppe of Mongolia is just stunning. And
that
region, again, is just one giant Ladakh for me. Those countries like Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, and stuff like that. Southern.
Yeah. They look stunning. And I'm sure they have amazing people and culture and the food. But now I feel like... I'm not sure what we would do next because a lot of countries are coming up with like long-term digital nomad visas, right? Like
Germany,
Estonia, Taiwan, Thailand. Some of them are fairly expensive, but some of them once the pandemic is over, they will really look into inviting digital nomads.
Right.
And the challenge for all these countries is that, now tourism will change to at least a fraction of tourism will become like people coming and staying long term because everybody has work from home.
Like work from vacation kind of thing.
Yeah. So the way to attract these people would be digital nomad visas.
Right.
So maybe the visa policies of certain countries will change because they don't want backpackers who have very little money to spend in the country. They would want people who... So, like, for example, the Estonia visa's maximum, minimum requirement is 4,000 euros a month or something like that.
Wow.
4,000 a month or 4,000 for six months? Yeah. So, something like that, right? So, and the Thailand one costs about $20,000 over a period of...
6 years.
Yeah, something like that. Okay. So, they want people who can afford to bring money into the country rather than just come and...
They want white people.
You'd be surprised. Quite a few Indians.
Not just white people.
Yeah. I'm just kidding. Yeah.
Backpackers who are white. So.
Yeah. Exactly. So that's.
I mean, at least like brown people, like we will, even if we don't have money, we will not go to Thailand and beg for money.
Yeah, for white people do beg in the streets. Right. Like they'd say that, okay, I'm playing the guitar or I'm playing. I'm selling stickers on the street or some nonsense.
Like, give me money because I want to travel in Thailand.
Yeah. I mean, is it fair to call that begging though? I mean, it's like
called backpacking. It's backpacking, but begging, so it's like backpacking.
it's kind of shaming them, right? Because
the goal is to shame them. Why are you from your first world country with such easy visa rules? You don't even have to apply for a visa. You just land up in Thailand or Indonesia, and the locals can't afford a day's food there. So if a local is playing a guitar on the street, we want to support them. But why are you coming and doing this in other poor countries? Do it in your country, no? Then we'll see.
I mean, you're taking money away from the locals.
Yeah, intentionally.
To what? To travel.
So yeah.
Which is a privilege.
And we shouldn't like a lot of people are very proud of going to the mountains in India and surviving on the kindness of strangers, like just being kind to locals, and locals are being kind to you. Like, okay, stay in my house for a few days or I will see you something. And that's nothing to be proud of. We feel that's just, you're just taking advantage of someone who is kind, who doesn't have enough for themselves, and they are just out of the kindness of their heart, they are helping you out.
I mean, you have every opportunity in the world being from a city or like a two-tier city.
Yeah.
You definitely have more opportunities than a guy in that village.
Yeah. What you're basically advocating is do that begging in your own city.
I mean,
and then go out.
Like, the thing is, traveling is a privilege.
Recognize
that it's a privilege. You need to have enough resources to pull travel off.
Yeah. And even if you're not begging, I feel like bring something to that place that you are going to. Like, pay rent to the locals, or maybe do some work for the locals, like work in a farm or something in exchange for a stay. Contribute something where you are going to a place which doesn't have enough.
Right.
And a lot of places, their sole income is tourism, right? All their income comes from tourism. So if you just go there and expect food and stay for free and show off that, okay, I spent 3 months here on just 100 rupees. That's like, there's nothing to show off about. You're just greedily taken from poor people. And there's no joy in taking from poor people. So it's better go beg in a city, bigger city where urban people can pay you if that is your goal to fund your travels. But don't take it from the locals.
Yeah. When I was staying in Scotland in a hostel, so there was this American girl in the hostel. She was like right beside my bed, and she was like, I was like, what are you doing here? I was like, I'm gardening. Like, where are you from? America. What did you do? I quit my job. So how long will you stay? I don't know. Where are you going next? Maybe in a month I'll go chill in Germany, work in Germany and come back. I mean, that is the kind of stuff you're advocating, right? Like, kind of just...
Yeah, do something to contribute. Like, at least she's paying rent wherever she's staying, right? Or she has some sort of arrangement that she will do the gardening and they will pay her for her food or whatever.
Right.
So that way, that I'm not against. See, you can do that for a few months.
There should be an exchange.
You have to contribute.
Right.
So you can do that for a few months. Maybe if you are up for it and you have find a partner who's also up for it, you can do that the rest of your life also. Nobody has to be ambitious, and you know, you don't have to become CEO of your company. You don't have to have the same goals as city people.
Right.
If you're open to living like that for your life, then well, that's your business, right? But for us, we feel that's not a goal for us. We want this to be a sustainable lifestyle. We want to be in a place where we have enough money for pleasure travel as well as investing in causes that we really care about. We don't want to be like traveling without money for years together, right?
We want to settle in some city.
Advocate that also.
Yeah.
We make sure that whenever we are writing about us, we are talking from the perspective of like travel is a privilege. You need to make money to have this lifestyle.
Yeah.
And it's not about just travel.
Yeah. So you can do this lifestyle even with basic money, like teaching English, working in a farm. If you want to do small things like that, maybe you can do it for 6 months to a year. You'll have to take a sabbatical. At some point, you have to think about, okay, what about my career? What about, you know, What about growth?
Do you think our corporates have the culture here in India, right? Because, you know, we take breaks in careers, like in Western countries, the work, they take breaks in the careers. They have a 1-2 year break of travel and then they come back and they join the company and, you know, some other job. But here it's a taboo, right? Taking a break is a taboo here in India, the work culture. And don't you think that is also like
it's a taboo everywhere else. It's just that some people are willing to take that risk. Even in India, it's the same. Some people are willing to take that risk. And I feel like a lot of seniority
age
is like a myth, right?
Yeah, sorry. I'm sorry. It's just that, like, for example, if I've worked in the IT industry for like 6 years, I'll take a year's gap and then go and then join, apply for a job again. I'm sure there'll be questions, right? Like, where the fuck were you? And, you know, those things, they matter, right? So, for example, I'm talking about that, but you were saying something. Sorry, go on.
Yeah, so what I'm saying is, like, for example, I quit my lawyer career just a little bit before we started traveling, around 27 or something. Right. And then after that, I looked into getting into social media or writing and stuff like that. And I was starting from scratch there. So when you are in your late 20s and you are starting at the level that a college graduate would start at, there will be looks and questions and people will be like, law karke you are working as a social media manager, like, right, what is wrong with you, right? So, and especially at the stage where by the time you're 30 as a lawyer, you can really make good money if you are working for a good firm or something like that. So at that level, to start from scratch, people, like, there will be people who will ask you questions and have like remarks for you, but if that is something you want to do, you have to know that, okay, I don't know anything about this career. I have to start where people start at, right?
Right.
Like the same with YouTubing as a career, that I do YouTube full time now. So
yeah,
there are 20-year-old YouTubers who are way more successful than me.
Right.
I have no issues like learning from them or thinking of them as my senior in the industry. Technically, they are.
We should learn from you. How many subscribers do you have? We should learn from you, madam. Come on.
Just 6,000-ish.
Yeah.
Right. That's not a joke. I mean, I've been doing this podcast for 6 months. I barely have. I mean, I don't want to reveal. I'm still in three digits. But by the way, so yeah, I was talking about work culture. So being independent, yeah, it's just this mystery. I don't know how one can achieve this balance.
Like, I think there is stigma even if you've taken a break to have a baby and come back. So imagine the stigma for you took a break to roam around and travel, like. Don't you care about your career?
I mean, the thing, there's another way to look at this. Yeah, the traditional corporate structure is not like feasible for this.
Right.
But there's a certain group of companies in Bangalore, like startups and like some corporates who basically understand these things now. So unfortunately, until you can't expect the whole industry to change so quickly. But you as an individual can go towards where the opportunity is.
Yeah.
Right.
So either go, like, for example, I know my friends who basically are in startups in India, in Bangalore,
right,
who make way more money than I do, and
right,
person in the US, and they have this lifestyle. Or even if they chose to be in Bangalore, they work from home, but not in the office. So there is, I mean, coronavirus and this pandemic has definitely opened a lot more people's eyes towards this, and a lot more opportunities will open up. But right now, we have to go where the opportunity is.
Right. And tell me about this. So you have traveled so much, met so many people. What are the top two biggest stereotypes that you just saw smashed in your head, just gone?
Well, I always... specific to the US, I always thought that because growing up, I had so many cousins and relatives move to the US, and US has been like the epitome of success for many middle-class Indians. It's like you are set if you do a master's in the US and get a job there.
Right.
But when I went to the US, I saw that American dream is very sad myth, actually. It's not...
How?
The dream is not what they make it seem. Like, what is the point of living in the suburbs somewhere there's nothing around? You drive like 40 kilometers to your office in your car and then you drive back 40 kilometers.
Right.
Weekends, you go to the Indian store and buy your dal and masalas and pickles.
Right.
And white people don't really, you can't assimilate into society because people are not really interested. Like,
I mean, you can.
But what will you do? Like, you'll drive 2 hours to the city from the suburbs.
Yeah.
But, and then you have kids and then you just, your life is just that. So. And then the only thing you look forward to is that yearly trip to India where you bring even more masalas and pickles back to the US and the cycle repeats.
And if you have a kid, you call your parents over for baby care.
Basically. And then if you go as a spouse, at least your husband will have like a friend circle from his office and he'll have something. But everything you know as a woman in the US will be like your friends, your husband's friends' wives or the other people who are like kind of in the same situation as you. And like your whole life will kind of revolve around sourcing sambar powder and just, you know, it's a life that I'm very glad that I didn't get into, because before I met him, my parents were really looking for guys in the US through shadi.com and stuff. And everyone I spoke to, they were like, yes, you come here, you know how to cook type. So I'm like, okay, dodged a big bullet. And the US is not really safe with guns. So I always make this joke. It's a bad joke, but it's like I dodged two bullets, one actual bullet, probably. And the other bullet.
Yeah, fair point. Yeah,
for me the biggest stereotype which the whole travel, actually the travel has opened up, is busted, is like people are the same everywhere. We all have different backgrounds, but we have the same fears, we have the same like things which make us happy.
Being a teenager is the same everywhere.
So it's like the backgrounds are different. That's what makes it fun to explore in different places. But ultimately, all people are the same. So much so, like if there is so much India versus China and stuff. But we have met so many Chinese in our travels, and
they are exactly like us. Indians. Yeah.
Like they're exactly like Indians in thinking, because we are both like a hugely populated country and we are basically bought into the world with amazing competition. And right, you have to you develop the same qualities like suspicion. The first thing when you basically meet someone,
lack of trust, this classic lack of trust.
Yeah.
Natural lack of trust, natural lack of empathy. So all these things are very similar with Chinese also. I'm not saying one is better than the other or we suck or no. Like we all have qualities which are there.
We all suck at some things or good at some things.
Exactly. Yeah. But ultimately, like if you come to Mexico, you will find like a Mexican has the same dreams as you have, but like a different background. That's it.
Right. And you speak of culture, right? Competition. Don't you think East Asia basically is more hardworking in terms of their work or something? Like, for example, you visited Japan. I'm not sure if you observed this. I have heard stories where guys and girls in proper tip-top corporate shirts and pants and dress lying on the road drunk at the end of the night.
Yep.
Because they were just worked their ass off.
Yeah.
They worked their ass off, and their drinking culture, which is like after the work is done, you and your colleagues basically go to an izakaya, which is a small pub, and you just drink.
And it's like if your boss calls you out to the pub, it's a part of your work culture. It's culturally wrong to say no to anything a boss says. So the partying is also like part of your work. You would be iced out, and you would be iced out of business if you didn't go out partying with your team.
Yeah.
So the party culture is like, I would say it's a part of your job. You have to make sure you are not hungover and ready to work the next day, but you have to be ready to party also.
Yuck. See, this was the thing, right? Not everything. We don't have to love everything about everyone. But one thing I totally love about Japan, I'm a massive fan of trains. I just, for some weird reason, I don't like flights. I don't like road travel. I like road travel when the roads are good, but not in India. Train is literally my favorite thing to travel in. And Japan and trains, that is the only reason I want to visit Japan. Am I right?
Yeah, literally, that was one of our top reasons also. And the best fun I think we had was like enjoying the train travel from the small, like everything from like small trains in the countryside to like the Shinkansen to the metro in Tokyo. It was like amazing. Like imagine just sitting in the Shinkansen. And it's so perfect. It's the stations are also so
perfect.
Where to where you went?
So I'm like.
So we landed in Tokyo, and the next day we took a flight to Hokkaido, and Hokkaido we explored by train a little bit.
Mostly by train.
Yeah.
Like local trains, and then we went to Hakodate, which is like the town.
Did you go to Hiroshima?
No.
Oh. So.
This what trip, like, we made sure it's only about Hokkaido because we wanted to see the fall colors in the winter.
Where is that place where there's a bunch of red pillars, a red kind of tunnel? Kyoto.
But the funny thing is, like, that's the most famous one, but you can find that everywhere in Japan.
Yeah, like, you have to know where it is.
It's just a feature in every temple.
Yeah.
Every temple, there is, like, those story gates, hundreds of them. But Fushimi Inari is the most famous one, which is in Kyoto.
Right.
And I fell sick that day, so we couldn't go to the one in Kyoto.
But we went to another place where with Tori Gates and stuff in Tokyo, in the middle of Tokyo. But the Shinkansen we took was from Hakodate to Tokyo, which covers like the northernmost point to Tokyo.
So roughly, how many kilometers we're talking about?
I don't remember how many.
But here's the thing. Here's what I did, right? Because sometimes when I'm like super bored, I plan trips just for the fun of it, right? So I'm like 500 kilometers between some Tokyo and Kyoto or some shit. It's like Bangalore to Hyderabad. Indian train takes 12 hours. This train takes like 2.5 hours.
Of course. Yeah, that's true. There's like high speed trains in Taiwan also. And the whole island you can cover in like 2 hours.
2 hours.
From top of the country to the bottom of the country. It's amazing. Yeah. And you won't even know you're on a train. It's so steady and so smooth and not that noisy.
So we covered 867 kilometers in 4 hours.
So, okay, let me put this in perspective. So Bangalore to Hyderabad is 500 plus maybe till Adilabad. So maybe Hyderabad to Coimbatore in 4 hours.
Yeah,
that is nuts. That is crazy.
It was amazing. Yeah,
fastest trains in the world, man. Shinkansen. That's the thing.
We had a flight, but we decided to get a refund and take the train because we just realized.
Good job. Good for you.
So a Japan trip was a little bit like. So what happened was you get 3 months visa to Japan, but since we were nomads, and I mean we are nomads. And we were looking for an onward ticket. The embassy told us you can't do that. You have to come back to India. Like you have to show a return ticket back to India.
Right.
So we wrote, they asked us to write a letter to the embassy.
Right.
Explaining that, okay, we are on a sabbatical and we don't know when our next destination is. And that's why we want a long-term visa and stuff. And they, instead of giving us the 3 months, they gave us 1 month. So, sometimes when we are not used to the kind of planning where you just plan like a week of trips and then decide, okay, on Thursday, I will be doing this.
Right,
I only have 3 days in this place.
Right.
So we did have like a loose plan, like, okay, from Sapporo to Tokyo, we'll fly back in a week. But you just happen to like a place more or you just discover something else to do. So that is that money. I feel like if we book a flight and we have to drop it, we just... Either we see if we can get a refund or we just, that is our maintenance money, as we call it.
Right.
So even in Mexico, we just booked the ticket to Belize.
No, it's called the fuck it money. Just fuck it. Like,
yeah.
basically. We lost it in a bet, yeah.
Yeah, so even in Mexico, we were like, okay, they might not give us the 6 months visa. So just in 2 months, let's book a ticket to Belize to just show that, look, we have a ticket out of Mexico. But when you got to Mexico, it was so chill. We got the 6 months visa, no questions asked. And when it was time to go to Belize, people were like, Belize is super expensive. It's not like a great place to go. Like one, when you need to do a visa run, do it. Otherwise, don't bother. So we just canceled and got the refund.
Wow.
We didn't get the
refund. Is it not refundable?
You know, these are the perks of not having that shitty sofa for 50,000 rupees.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. So this is like, we joke with our friends who have cars. We call it our car maintenance money. That every year you'll have to put in some money for something is broken, something is scratched or something like that. That is our ticket money that we lose. It's okay.
Right.
Like for example, Singapore, they wanted us to book a ticket back to India. So, and they wouldn't accept it any other way. Like we couldn't write to the embassy or anything. So we basically booked a refundable ticket to Chennai and then we moved onwards to Vietnam, but we canceled the ticket once we landed.
You don't like plans, but do you like plans sometimes? For example, like for me, one of like some, like I, because I, when I was going to UK, I was on a tight budget and I had to plan everything right down to the detail. I'm talking about clockwork detail, right? I'm talking about 10 a.m. to 12 a.m. here. So I don't want to waste even a single hour, right? So I, and the entire trip just went exactly the way I wanted it to. Just literally not even 1% deviation, right? Does that sound fun to you sometimes? What is your relationship with planning? What is your relationship? Because unplanned trips kind of are expensive sometimes, right? For example, it kind of goes overboard sometimes. What is your relationship with planning when it, as a traveler by yourself? How much do you plan? How much don't you plan? You know, stuff like that.
So a lot of times we just land up in a country. So if our plan is basically to see which country is nearby, what is the visa rules like, and what are the flight prices like. So if we are in...
That's it. That's your homework.
Basically. So if we are in Malaysia, we'll be like, okay, can I go to Thailand? Can I go to Indonesia? Can I go to Vietnam? Can I go to Singapore? So those are like, that is the max extent of our planning. And then we land there and then we see, okay, what is there to do here? Let's see. So for example, we, from the US, we knew we wanted to go to Colombia. We landed in Medellin and then we're like, the top places that we, the cities we want to explore are these. So let's see how long we want to stay in a city. So Cartagena turned out to be a really hot city. So we decided, we don't like crazy hot weather. So okay, let's just come back to Medellin. And then Bogota, we went for a week, but Bogota was really, really a cool city. So we're like, okay, three weeks here.
Right.
Till we leave. The same with, and then we were like, okay, what country is nearby that we can enter? So the options are Brazil, Ecuador, and Peru. So Ecuador has now banned Indians.
What the? Why?
Yes. Okay, so... usually India has a visa on arrival to Ecuador.
Okay.
But because of some massive Indian trafficking scam, they've changed the visa policy for only for Indians. And it's now $600 on arrival. So we are like, $600 for 15 days is absolutely undoable, right? It doesn't make any sort of sense unless you desperately want to see Ecuador, but we're like, no, it's okay. We can wait. So they are waiting to solve the situation where they can say that, okay, Indians who have US visa can enter for 3 years.
Yeah, we don't know yet.
Not yet, but the time that we were in Colombia, it had just become a massive scam where somebody was running an Indian restaurant, but on the behind of the restaurant, they were trafficking a lot of Indians. They trafficked so many people.
This is hearsay.
Yes, but they had trafficked so many people that the government had to block Indians from coming. Imagine.
Oh. Is that the Indians' shortcut to like kind of US border to Mexico and ship like that?
They promise and traffic people and leave them in Ecuador.
And you get stuck in Ecuador.
So a bunch of Indians were trying to actually cross the Darien Gap by foot.
This is a forest with no roads, nothing. You can't enter.
This is, like, you're talking about Central America.
This is a place where the government has not been able to construct roads through this forest. So
you're talking about Nicaragua border and shit like that,
no,
right?
No. Panama and Colombia.
Okay, right.
Yeah.
So So they were trying to cross that on foot, and they were discovered by the military, Ecuadorian military, and accidentally were shot. Like 15 Indians died in that.
When did this happen? I never got a hold of this.
I think last year, yeah.
And then they basically they decided to stop the visa on arrival for Indians. That was the catalyst to stop. But yeah, getting back to the point, like we basically just try to...
Whatever's nearby. So from Colombia, we decided let's go to Peru.
Right.
And Peru to either Chile or Bolivia, you can do land border crossing. So we just went in an auto.
Wow.
So we had exceeded our Peruvian visa by 2 days, and they asked us to pay a fine. And this was the border at the middle of nowhere, right? There's nothing around.
Yeah.
So they were like, okay, take an auto, go to the bank, pay the fees and pay the fine and come back. And yeah, we took an auto in the Peru-Bolivian border.
I will do that. And when I do that, I'll be selfieing myself like, bro, I'm crossing a country in auto. Like, check this shit out. So, that is nuts.
We went to Peru and we went to Cusco, and basically our plan was to stay there for a month.
Hmm.
And we found this guy from Garhwal in Uttarakhand who has reopened an Indian restaurant in Cusco, and he had amazing Indian home cooked Indian food.
Yeah, where would be like dal chawal banado and all that.
What the fuck is this? His story, by the way. Like, what the hell? In
so we have a video coming out about his story. Basically, he just really wanted to.
If it is something interesting, interesting, please don't link.
Yeah.
Please don't link.
So basically, he came from India to Peru. He liked it enough to live here, and he set up his restaurant here.
Exactly. I mean, I was in Thailand in Phuket because I had this hotel booked because there was this infinity pool. I wanted to check out the infinity pool. And I was just roaming around the street, and there was this clothing shop with a Sardar as its owner. I'm like, dude, in Phuket, what the hell are you doing? Like, you should be in freaking Canada or Britain.
Indian
right.
Like, even Mexico here, we see there's a couple of Indian stores selling kurtas and stuff because Mexicans love it. They love buying Indian jhumkas and kurtas. And it's nice to see that they're
Indian. But in Thailand, I think it's for Indians,
yeah. Phuket was very, very unique because... You know,
hey, I'm really sorry. I'm really sorry. Pattaya. I'm very sorry. I didn't go to Phuket. It was Pattaya. Pattaya
is just made for Indians. It's only like, just for Indians. Phuket was really unique because Phuket, you think it's only beaches and parties and stuff like that.
Mm.
But Phuket, actually, the name comes from Bukit, which means hill. So Phuket is a city of hills.
Mm.
So if you leave those two touristy beach areas in Phuket, Phuket is so incredibly like different, diverse, like there's so much to explore.
Right. And tell me this, can you bitch a little about Corona as travelers, please? I mean, because I am pissed as hell because I didn't get to go to Australia and places like that. You tell about yourself. I mean, you can spend another 2 hours bitching about it, but I don't know how brief you want to keep it.
That I would bitch about Corona is the fact that visas for Indians might get complicated because India is like the second worst affected after the US. So already Indian passport is like amazing. So because of Corona, it might just become the second, like it might become like really bad.
Right.
So that's my only concern. Otherwise, we just landed up in Mexico, which is as badly affected as India.
Right.
It's just that they are not counting the numbers here in Mexico or doing any sort of keeping any sort of statistics or testing or anything.
Right.
So that way, we are not better off in either country. Things in Mexico are open, but in India, we would have had like strict lockdown. So we are glad to be in Mexico.
Right.
But visa-wise, I really hope...
No, personally, how were you affected? Were you pissed off? Were you like...
I think you were a little pissed off. But for me, we usually just keep moving every 2 to 3 months.
Hmm.
So coming to Mexico and spending like 6 months, that is the longest that we have spent anywhere in 4 years. So for me, it was like, I really liked slowing down in Mexico City. We had a lot of friends here and we made some more friends. So we got to really enjoy Mexico in a different way.
Right.
So I'm happy to be stuck for a while.
After the 6 month mark, I was done.
Yeah.
Right. Everyone.
It's not like I want to go outside of Mexico. Just I don't want to be in Mexico.
Right.
Tomorrow I have to go to the doctor to get my wisdom tooth removed. So
right. But are you scared in a sense as a traveler to like now like go? Because our thing is basically public transport, and now public transport is one of the most unsafe modes of transport, yeah, exactly. Right? So, I mean, psychologically, you know, you must be doing some changes to the way you travel, right?
Yeah, so we haven't taken a flight, and if we go somewhere, we might have to take
a public transport either.
No.
Mm. We just have 10 cabs around the city. And ideally, I want to find a bike and go in a bike, but that has not happened. But we have not taken any public transport yet.
Right.
I don't know when we will crack and do it, but
right.
But right now we haven't.
That's yeah. It. So I think we will be a little bit apprehensive. Like we'll keep sanitizer and wipes and face shields and whatnot. But there's only so much you can do, right?
Yeah.
If you take the decision to travel during the pandemic.
Right. I mean, that is the only thing that's stopping me from going to Vietnam. I'm just kidding. But
Vietnam's response was pretty amazing. Like
yes,
they had almost zero deaths for a very long time.
Exactly.
So that was pretty good.
Right. And but how do you know, it's not your job to convince or something, but how do you explain it, this lifestyle, to someone who's addicted to his salary, right? Because the idea of a constant salary is you cannot really underestimate the comfort that it gives, right?
Yeah.
So
that's the thing, right? Like right now I do get a salary. Like even if I'm freelancing, I have a fixed salary which comes in every month.
Right.
So that's the thing. It is a completely it is a possibility for you to get a salary and do this now.
Right.
Especially after Corona.
Yeah. Right. Freelance is not the same as working 9 to 5 and getting that salary. There's a difference between being a consultant and being like a full-time employee. Like for him, he doesn't have to do 9 to 5 when his team is doing 9 to 5. He's free to work like a few hours in the morning and then take the day off and then come back in the night and work.
So I have a lot of flexibility in that way, like when I can work and how I can work. But it is a big, like after the Corona, because so many things have gone remote now, it is going to stay remote after also. And you can be a salaried, and that's the thing. When you want to quit and travel the world, what we mean is not like quit your job and just blow through your savings. What we mean is like
quit your full-time job or quit your corporate job or whatever.
Like initially, when we started, that's what you had to do because the only option was freelance.
Right.
But now you don't need to do that. You can keep your job and travel.
Right.
But it is a kind of sacrifice in the sense that if you specifically want to work for some upcoming startup in Bangalore, there's way more money that you could earn from them than freelancing, right?
Right.
If you really wanted to be part of that industry. And
that will come down to then priorities then. What do you want?
Yeah. Exactly. So I feel like that being, there's nothing wrong being addicted to the comfort of a paycheck every month. It's just something we are used to. We have, as middle-class Indians, we have seen our parents grow up with. So even the idea of a 3 month sabbatical or taking some time between two jobs is like, why are you taking 2 months between a between two jobs? Like, what will you do? So that is also like shocking to so many Indians.
Yeah.
But I think it's okay. It's just something that if you are in a position that you don't have too many responsibilities or you don't have parents to take care of or something like that, if it is a possibility that you can imagine a different life, then anything going against society will always have people talking, but
yeah,
people are going to talk anyway. So,
right. Yeah. What, I mean, if not for Corona, what were your plans?
Oh, wow. So we were thinking of going down to Chile and Argentina. And I really also want to see Uruguay because that is a very cool country.
Right.
Don't tell it. It has an amazing startup, digital nomad culture, and Montevideo is one of the top cities to be in South America. So I was really curious about exploring.
Start from the top of South America.
But when we were in Bolivia, we were still considering where would we be like to stuck be stuck for maybe if 6 months to a year, if the corona becomes very serious.
Right.
So by the time we made the decision, Argentina and Chile had already closed their borders.
Right.
And we can't continue to stay in Bolivia because the only way out of Bolivia is either go to Peru or Brazil or Argentina, because there are no flights out of, direct flights out of Bolivia.
Right.
So we went to Peru because just a neighboring country, and we are supposed to get like 3 months visa in Peru, but they only gave us 6 days. So that was clear that, okay, they are giving on a case-to-case basis. They are asking people to leave. So there's no way we can try to get an extension and stay in Peru. So we went to Panama, and then from Panama, we came to Mexico City, hoping that they will give us, because Mexico is the only place that will give you 6 months. Everyone else gives you 3-ish months.
Wow. Okay.
So Mexico gave us 6 months, no questions asked. They were like, welcome to Mexico, right in the pandemic in March, mid-March. So we're like, okay, let's stay here. And then after 6 months, it was really easy to extend the, and get another 6 months visa as well.
Right.
So our visa expired in September, and basically they gave us what they call a humanitarian visa extension, where you say, you write a letter saying that there's no way back to your country. So I have, I want to extend it. So there were these Vande Bharat flights, but we decided to say that there are no flights to India, please extend.
Oh, so imagine
the US people and the Canadian people are getting their visas rejected. White people are getting their visas rejected.
I mean, not at that point of time.
Yeah, that point of time they gave.
What a sweet justice, right? Like, for example, like when the pandemic started, there was this Italian tourist. I read the story somewhere. Italian tourist who got his visa rejected by Nigeria. A black guy rejecting the visa of a white guy. That is... Oh, yes. Oh, that was just so sweet. Yeah. I mean, now what are your plans, basically? Like, because now pandemic is here, right?
So Costa Rica is open.
But I don't think that's in the plan.
But no, it's not in the plan. US is open. But the thing is that if we want to do a visa run, because now they won't extend because the flights are all back up. So if we have to get a fresh visa, we have to step out of the country and come back. So, so either if you decide, okay, let's go back to India. It's been a while since we've been to India. Since I think 2018, December, we have not been to India.
Right.
So I think it's a better idea to just go to India, figure out vaccine and stuff, just see family and all that, and then see where we will travel based on what visas are up. Or if you feel like, oh, we must stay in Mexico, we might do a visa run. We don't know yet.
Do you know these vaccine trips that Indians travel companies have started? Like, go to UK, come back in 3 days, 1,50,000. Again.
But how much is the vaccine, though?
How much? No, it's all included in the package.
Okay.
Right. You know, breakfast free and then vaccine free.
But you paid for it, and I'm sure the vaccine in the US is going to be way more expensive than India. So
no, this is for UK. I've seen plans for UK actually. So because UK has started already, if I don't know if you're aware of it, right? So yeah, I mean, that can be done. That is another business that you guys can open. But hey,
no, imagine shepherding people to get the vaccine.
Yeah, but don't. What is your future in terms of your like financially, your plans, right? So are you going to continue with YouTubing, Instagramming? You just go with the flyer. Do you have any plans that you don't want to leak or you know, stuff like that?
We really want to make sure that YouTube and Second Breakfast can be
can sustain our
nomadic lifestyle full time. And ideally we would want to stop the freelancing and be full time creators.
Right.
So that will still take a while because it's not so easy to do that. But that is our goal at some point. And then we also want to see if we can get a long-term visa in either Europe and Africa. And a long-term visa to Japan. So without getting a job in either of these places. So, it is possible. They are introducing all sorts of specific startup visas and freelancer visas. So a bit of research and stuff will make it possible for us, I feel. But we'll see if we want to slow down more or if we want to settle down. I don't think we want to settle down.
I mean, I'm not in any mood to settle down in a single place.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Your goals, your true goals. I mean, if if you're planning a trip for UK, right, leave that plan on me. All right. I can give you the inside out of UK because I've explored the crap out of that place, and it's basically India but neat. UK, it's just we got from them obviously, but they all have this. Yeah. They all have circles. They still have circles, you know, where they take turns, and then yeah, and their school kids wear uniforms and shit. I mean, and it's just so much of India, and the food is. I think UK is the most convenient foreign country for an Indian outside South Asia, because the availability, the variety of the food is just so abundant. Anywhere you go, you get any masala.
Like Indian food.
Mean Indian food?
Yeah, Indian food. They have curry paste, they have tomato puree and all that shit. I mean, it's crazy. UK is just India neat.
Asian food is very important to us. Like, we yeah. don't care if it doesn't have Indian food, but it should have good Japanese, good Thai, good Vietnamese food. Is like, now traveling Asia, I felt like our comfort food from Indian food went to Asian food.
Huh. So
now, I just want once in 3 months dosa and I'm good.
Yeah, just dosa maybe. Not
once
even
once in 3 months, one dosa is enough for me to satisfy my Indianness in it.
Right.
And I just want chaat masala and then I'm good. So I just carry chaat masala. I can just put it on any fruits or anything that I want. Like chaat is something that I can go without Indian food, but chaat is something which is very India specific, that is very hard to get outside of India.
Right. Good yeah, trip. Maybe if the Bangalore guy is planning a trip to Vietnam, so probably pack a kilo of chaat masala, dump it inside the suitcase and just leave it there.
Because other things also, like the green chutney, imli chutney, you can, if you want to make chaat, if you are serious, you can make chaat here.
Right.
But chaat is something that I truly miss. I feel like that is something, I don't care for any other Indian food. Like, I'm not dying to eat it, and maybe we eat Indian food like once in 2 months.
Yeah. And I was just, when I was traveling as a new traveler, when I was in Thailand on that boring trip, I just totally had my entire food on Subway. Because I was so scared. I was just so scared. Look, I don't know what these folks sell. Everything is closed. I'm like, okay, only Subway is open. So I was having the Subway was my meal. That was my meal place. But I didn't have any other problems. I don't know. You guys have cleared my fear for food availability in Southeast Asia, and also crime levels in Latin America.
If you're ever doubtful of the food, you just look on the Google Maps, just see what university or college is around, and then go there. And then at lunch break, people will stream out and go to one specific food joint, or there will be a couple of affordable, cheap and delicious food near schools and colleges. So that's, if you are ever in doubt, we go to those areas.
Yeah. And if you're a nomad, you have to think on your feet, kind of, right? Because there was this one journey when I went to Manchester, right, unplanned, and I had everything planned. One thing I missed was, like, where will I stay in Manchester? I landed in Manchester early in the morning. I wanted to visit the Old Trafford Manchester United Stadium, and there was like 4 hour gap. I'm like, where the fuck will I brush my teeth? Where will I freshen up? I'm like, I had no clue. So it was cold as hell, right? It's Manchester, right? It is so cold. Now, what I thought of, every other hostel was full. So what I did, I booked a gym session for 2 hours. Gym has a shower, gym has a sink. So I went there, acted like I was working out, and then had a shower there, and then, you know, freshened up myself. So, you know, thinking on your feet is kind of, I mean, this fear is also the fun part of traveling solo, right? Just, you're lost in a place where you don't know the language.
Yeah.
And being clueless is also kind of fun. It's like, you have no clue where to go. That is the part of the fun.
Yes, definitely. I think you just discover something new every time.
Right.
You'll get used to it if you just keep an open mind. And fear is something like, okay, you have to be a bit fearful of things that you wouldn't do in your city only, like go roam crazy neighborhood at night with all your tech stuff with you and stuff, that you are asking for trouble if you do that.
Right.
So what you wouldn't do in your own city, be mindful in a market that somebody will pickpocket or something, that you have to be everywhere else.
Right.
And unless the locals tell you something like, okay, locals tell us that this one area in Mexico City, don't go without a local friend.
Right.
So yeah, you would listen to them, but more or less, I feel like most places are safe that we've been to.
Exactly. Unlike movies. By with that, I have broken the record of my longest podcast on my channel, because this is my favorite topic. I can just go on for another 2 hours, because you must have so many stories to talk about. But I suggest you, if you want to start a podcast channel of your own, obviously you're doing YouTube.
Yeah, we keep saying every year we are like, we start a podcast. Last year, this year, January, we were like, okay, let's start a podcast. We are in Peru and stuff, but somehow we didn't. And now we are like, okay, there's no excuse. Now you are in one place, just do it.
Yeah, that is exactly. I wouldn't have started the podcast if not for the lockdown, actually. Because I was like, okay, karenge. But now I was like so bored. I'm like, okay, now let's start one. So I started one. Now it's 50 episodes. And this is by far my favorite episode. Thank you very, very much for your time. And I don't know if you have any parting message to folks listening to you, but if you want to say something.
Yeah, maybe just like things will change after the pandemic. So make your own decisions. You must have already realized in the pandemic that people who are important to you, like, don't listen to your relatives and other annoying people, judgy people. Just design your dream.
Relatives are like, are the ones who you listen to, then that's different.
But yeah, you might have cool relatives.
Don't don't listen to the one that pester you.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. So just, if you have a dream life and if you think that you can make it possible, don't be like you have to make it possible the next month or something. Take this time, take 1, 2, or 3 years, especially if you are in your 20s, to design the type of life that you are excited, that every Monday you feel like, wow, it's Monday again. I get to do this on Monday, instead of living for Friday and hating Mondays.
Right. Just, right.
Like, make sure that you are the priority and you spend your money how you want to.
Excellent note to end this podcast. Thank you very much once again, Avinash and Ruchi. Absolute pleasure having you. May you travel a lot. May you have more stories to say to the world. You're a true inspiration. Before letting you go, please tell about your social media presence. Your name of your channel is Second Breakfast. Your Instagram, can you just tell a bit about your Instagram, Facebook, everything? Where can we find you?
So it's youtube.com/secondbreakfast, and you'll find the link to other places on YouTube itself.
Right.
And the Instagram handle is @haveasecondbreakfast.
Excellent. That's it, folks. Go check out and get jealous. Get jealous, especially on a Monday morning. Get jealous. That's it from the Solo Cups podcast. Till we see you next time with a different episode. Bye, everyone.